gentlemen, the show is about to start in 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
It'll be fine on the mountain.
It's time for Inside the Gamecocks, the show. Built by the Barnuminium Company, served by Chicken Cock Whiskey, and part of the Chief Sports Network.
Juice Wells, all the way, touchdown Gamecocks.
Pressure, and he just dives in.
Dozier, notice.
It will be a lot louder than that on Saturday night. Greetings and good morning. Welcome aboard and welcome home inside the Gamecocks, the show, live always from the Signorama Studios. They're the preferred sign partner of Gamecock Athletics, and they're ours as well. Signorama.com. Matt Vaughn's team is excellent. That is why the Gamecocks choose them every single year. We choose to drink Chicken Cock Whiskey around here, even outside of football season. Hope you've got a bottle. It's Thanksgiving and rivalry week. Good time to have that in the liquor cabinet. And of course, we're built by the Barn Dominium Co., the Barn Do Co., the BarnDominiumCo.com, where you can build your dream home in four states, the Carolinas, Georgia, and in Tennessee, for as low as $160 per square foot. Four screens already, JC, JB, and Phil, and Hale, yeah, McGranahan, a couple of days here shy of Turkey Day. Happy Thanksgiving and happy Thanksgiving week to all of you, and we certainly appreciate you spending your morning and afternoon with us. Hale, what's up? Glad to have you, man.
Yeah, appreciate you guys having me on as usual here on a Tuesday morning, a rainy Tuesday morning in Columbia.
I know. It's raining down here, too. Kind of sucks. But get it out of here before the weekend gets here so we don't have to deal with it on Saturday. It doesn't look like we will, but it will be chilly, I believe, on Saturday evening. So, all right, let's just, we'll get right to the news of the evening slash day. Hale, what's the latest on Juice Wells?
Yeah, he formally said he's coming back. Put all the speculation to bed. I'll say there wasn't a lot of speculating going on amongst us at the Big Spur. Like, I'd been hearing good things about him coming back, and I think JC and Whittle and Tony had all been hearing that it was very much in play that he could indeed be back for 2024, and he put all that to bed last night with a tweet or a post on X, whatever you want to call it. And yeah, he said he's coming back. So it's early good news for next year's team, and I guess folks are now dreaming of Lenore Sellers and Juice Wells and what that might look like. So a reason to feel good heading into next year already, regardless of what happens on Saturday.
I always find the look ahead drama funny. There's a Clemson-Carolina matchup coming this weekend, and we're talking about Lenore Sellers and Juice Wells versus Old Dominion on August 31st in 2024. You got to love college football, Hale. It is big news. I agree. You know, there's been a lot of speculation, and y'all staff and our there's been enough information to where when he finally said that yesterday, we kind of just nodded our heads like, okay, well, glad that's over. The other side of it is the second guessing side of that tweet is that he did not specifically say, I'm not playing in the Clemson game. Is there anything more to read into, or should we just wait 2.5 hours to hear from Shane Beamer?
I'm going to wait 2.5 hours to hear from Shane Beamer.
That sounds good.
Yeah.
And we'll just end that conversation there. Okay, before we get into the actual game stuff, I know you and JC, let's see, it's the 21st. So we're talking about 2 weeks here where things are going to get quite interesting. You got the portal set to open. You've got the early signing day coming up. The Gamecocks just had a lot of players in town. They've got more coming this weekend to watch that team from the upstate play against South Carolina. Do you have an opening recruiting report for us off of any feedback off of the Kentucky game that you can dish out?
Well, it was a fantastic atmosphere. Anybody who was there in person can certainly speak to that and probably could tell on TV as well. Could definitely get to tell on TV as well. That's the thing that matters the most is an atmosphere that's lively and is exciting and all that. The team, of course, can't come out and crap the bed, which we have seen in the past over the years when it's a big game at Williams-Brice, and it lived up to the hype. South Carolina didn't disappoint. They won the game. So it seems like there's plenty of reason to feel good about who was there and all that. There was an interview that Cam Fountain did that made it seem a little bleak for South Carolina being able to flip him from Southern Cal, but we've reported on the Big Spur, and Steve Wolfong from 24/7 has done the same, that we actually feel good about where South Carolina stands still, as despite what's been said by Fountain himself. Quasheed Scott was committed to Kentucky, was in for the game. That visit went well, and there have been a bunch of 2025s and some guys who are committed that made it in, and yeah, it's going to be an even bigger group of recruits this weekend for the Clemson game. And if that game lives up to the hype and South Carolina can play well and have a good atmosphere, we know the atmosphere is going to be good. But if the team can play well and maybe, just maybe, pull out a win, you would have to think that it would be another feather in the recruiting cap for Shane Beamer and those guys.
Yeah, I want to make sure. Yeah, there you go, JC. I want to make sure I lump you into this because the Cam Fountain situation is interesting here. There's conflicting reports out there. You know, Phil Kornblut with Sports Talk is part of our network. You can watch or listen to them on the Chief Sports app. But he had that pretty direct comment. It was like, yeah, no, I'm sticking to my – I'm a man of my word. I'm sticking it out with Southern Cal. But from what I understand, there's a whole world of media guys from 24/7, the Big Spur, all of y'all, you know, and others out there that seem to contradict that. I want to make sure you two guys get all the say on this, because I don't know what the hell's going on.
This is where it gets hard. I mean, this is where recruiting coverage and things like that, you know, take weird turns. I figured out a long time ago, don't pay any attention to anything anybody tweets. Don't pay any attention to anything anybody puts on Instagram. Don't pay any attention to anybody that gives direct quotes. And if you think about it, South Carolina had a receiver that publicly gave the rare public leader the entire time and ended up at NC State this year. They have a running back target that gave the rare public leader the entire process, may end up at Alabama. So the point is, don't take quotes too seriously. These kids are young. They're under a lot of pressure. They don't want to tell people no. They don't want to disappoint folks. And they don't really want to hear, after they've made a visit someplace else, when that visit's gone well, they really don't want to hear from that other staff with a million questions as to why they said this to the reporter or whatever. And they're too young to kind of realize that when you make statements like, I'm a man of my word, you know, that's not supposed to just sound good. That's supposed to be legit. But when you're young, you know, it's hard to kind of, you know, it's kind of hard to question anybody's character and stuff like that. Because when we were that age, we'd have done the same daggum thing, you know. And we live in a buzzword, buzz phrase type society where I think people repeat phrases sometimes. They don't really understand what it means. So I that's my take on that. I understand why he said what he said, but we have our information too, and it would be a surprise if that were the case. Now, will he ultimately end up at South Carolina? I think there's a good shot, but it's not done yet. And I do think that you know, he's still committed publicly to Southern Cal, so I mean, you know, the hay is not in the barn. But, you know, that kind of statement tends to just close the door and you move on, but nobody's moving on behind the scenes. So that's my take on that. Hale, what's your take?
Yeah, I agree. I mean, we can point to DJ Braswell, for example, who put out a top four that didn't include South Carolina a couple weeks before he was supposed to commit and ended up committing to South Carolina. So it's recruiting. That's something to keep in mind here. Sometimes intentionally guys are deceptive. Sometimes they don't even mean to be deceptive and they are. They just, you know, like JC was kind of saying, young minds and that type of deal. So we're still hearing good things. So we'll see what plays out over the next few weeks as we get closer to that early signing period. But yeah, all indications are that South Carolina is still very much in play for Cam Fountain.
Yeah, I want to ask you this, too. You got the chance to talk to Dylan Stewart after the game Saturday, didn't you? Was that you?
No.
Was that Alex?
No. He wasn't at the game. He had his own game Saturday, Brian Doan.
Oh, okay. I didn't read the byline. But anyway, he pretty much firmed everything. I mean, there was really no speculation that he was going to flip. But he pretty much firmed everything up, right?
Yeah. The last Saturday, the Kentucky game was the first home game he has not been to this season. And I believe he's got another game on Saturday this weekend. So I don't believe he'll be at the Clemson game either. But like you were saying, JC, he was talking about how we're going to be good and all that. So he's locked in and all that. There's not going to be any wiggle there with Dylan Stewart.
You mentioned him not being there. Is there a list of players that is currently available that will be there this weekend?
I haven't published anything this week. I have. It might have been last week's VIP room. I put a list out, but I'll be posting something on the Big Spur at some point, probably today, kind of a preliminary list of names, if you will.
Okay. All right. Specifically to the football game this past weekend, how about that Gamecock defense, Hale?
They look good. I mean, Devin Leary missed some throws, and yep. I haven't gone back and counted up some of those deep throws that he missed or when exactly they were, but I do recall there being like two or three on a drive that they still got a touchdown on. And there was at least one later on in the game, but they kind of got away from trying to push the ball downfield like they did. And I thought they were going to keep going to that because clearly South Carolina has struggled defending the deep ball at times this season. Maybe they got to Leary a little too much. They knocked him around a couple good times. I mean, that hit Debo Williams put on him when he was scrambling. I probably should have made more of an emphasis on that and some of the stuff I wrote after the game on Saturday. But, you know, Devin Leary didn't want anything to do with stepping up into that pocket and making throws. And you know, we've talked all season about how a lack of a pass rush has affected this South Carolina team at times. But again, we saw at the end of the game, Jordan Strong getting to the quarterback and making a play and how it just important that is, how much it can change a game when you can have defensive linemen who can affect the quarterback. And you said, we saw what Kentucky's Deion Walker did, big number zero, and he was all in the backfield, the Carolina backfield. So anytime you can have guys in that front four making plays behind the line of scrimmage, that's going to change things. And you know, people might look at some of the offensive results from Carolina on Saturday and be concerned, especially with what Clemson's got on their defensive line. But and that Walker guy totally wrecked that game for about two and a half quarters on Saturday night, and just really made life difficult offensively. But the defense, going back to your question, JB, that those guys, they're getting better, man. That there's no denying that. Their guys are making plays finally. Whether it's Strawn, like I said, or Nicky Manwari with that interception. You know, we've talked a lot about Jalen Kilgore over the last few months, and he made some plays as well. So never too late to have some guys start stepping up
Here this season. Yeah, now 9 turnovers, guys, in the month of November in these last 3 games at home. That's how they win. It looks like that 3-3-5 has allowed them to get some additional hands on the ball too, because there's been a lot of tip passes over the last couple of weeks around there. I want to go to that play that you talked about just a minute ago. I rewatched everything last night. It was not targeting. It was called unnecessary roughness. They threw a 15-yard flag on Debo Williams. I'd be anxious to hear, if somebody does get a chance to ask Shane today, how are you supposed to coach that any differently? Because Debo Williams was going to make a tackle before – I mean, it was split second, but it was before this guy committed to – Devin Leary committed to going to the ground. I just don't know, and we've seen this a lot, and let's get away from the South Carolina game. Let's just talk about college football. I've seen that flag thrown 4 or 5 times this year on guys who don't quite commit to going down yet, and a player comes in and puts a big bang on him, and because he went ahead and committed to going down, they throw a 15-yard penalty. I mean, I'm not sure. What are you supposed to do? Just run over to him and hope that he falls to the ground? I mean, what does college football want out of this? I don't understand what they want to do with it.
Yeah, I think Debo got penalized for playing football on Saturday night. That was not a penalty to me. And JB, Kenny Pickett kind of found a little cheat code a couple of years ago in the ACC. I think it was Kenny Pickett in the ACC championship where he's running up a sideline and he fakes like he's going to slide, like sells it really well and sees the defender kind of slow up. Then he takes off and keeps booking it up the sideline and I think scored a touchdown. So, I mean, it is really hard to play defense, especially in the NFL these days, but in college football as well. And everyone should probably be cognizant of that when we're, you know, talking about South Carolina's defense, for example, and some of the issues they've had in tackling. Like it is very hard to play defense effectively, not only because referees call it differently in games, but it's, you know, you can't practice like they used to back in the day. I know it sounds really like old man yelling at clouds saying that, but it's just, it's not like it used to be, and everyone's making this game cater towards offense, and it's more, you know, appealing to people watching on TV for sure. But it is very hard to play defense, and that tackle we're talking about, that hit Debo had, is just one of several examples you can point to.
Yeah, JC, we didn't talk about this yesterday, Phil. I mean, I don't know how you coach that any differently. I mean, it's not like he just went in there head first and got kicked out of the game for targeting. He was just trying to make a tackle. I will say this though. As soon as that happened and those Kentucky guys got mouthy with him, boy, that flipped a switch in Jordan Strawn, you know, and that's what Jordan Strawn basically got in the guy's face, like, no, you're not going to do that here, big boy. And so that was really neat to see, but it's pathetic. It's really pathetic that that's where we are in college football. They've got to figure out a way to fix that.
It's in the NFL.
That should be reviewable.
It's in the NFL, too. They called unnecessary roughness on either a guard or a fullback on a touchdown run in the NFL the other day. And there was no planet. I mean, the guy, he was just blocking hard, which is what you're supposed to do. I mean, everybody talks about injuries. You're going to get hurt if you play tentative in this game, in this sport. That's when guys get hurt.
Yeah.
Not when they're going all out. And Debo, I mean, if it's not targeting, how in the world Is it unnecessary roughness? Wait, what are you even talking about? Did he tackle him too hard? Oh no. Is that a rule now? I thought that's why we had targeting.
Right.
You know, I mean, it's stupid. I mean, it makes me sick.
I think whichever referee threw the flag probably threw the flag thinking targeting. And I'm guessing, I don't know, I'm just speculating here. I would guess after he threw the flag and spoke about it with some of the other refs, they're like, that wasn't targeting. Well, we got to call something. We threw the flag. He knocked the shit out of him. Like, let's call it unnecessary roughness, even though the guy wasn't even on the ground. And I know, to give yourself up, but like, Debo's already making the tackle, going to make the tackle before that even.
It's asinine. They need to be able to review plays like that. It's insane.
If it's not targeting, it shouldn't be 15 yards, period.
Yeah. 100% agree with that. There's no reason. There's not a reason in the world that they cannot figure out how to put that into the rule book that says that can be reviewed, period. Because there's just no reason for that. There's too much of a gray area. Look, I'm not saying that these officials are perfect or that they have to be perfect. That's never going to happen. It's never happened before, and it's never going to happen. It just is what it is. Okay, I can't say that I wouldn't have thrown the flag there too. It's what your eyes see. You've got dudes running all over the place. They're flying around. It's quick. It's happening lightning quick, you know. So I might have thrown a flag there as well, but there's no reason that they can't go back and look at that and say, no, this kid hadn't even given himself up yet, you know. So anyways, all right, we'll move off of that. Hale, they're going to have to be able to run the football to beat Clemson, though. They couldn't do it this past weekend. The defense won the game for them, and I'm pretty convinced that that's not going to happen this go-around. They're going to have to find a way to run it better.
I don't know. They didn't really run the ball last year against Clemson and found a way to win. So,
Okay. Well, then, yeah. Never mind.
No, you're right though, JB. They're gonna have to find much more consistency than they had last week against Kentucky, because Clemson's defensive line is they don't have just one Deion Walker. I don't know if anybody's as good that they've got, but they've got a bunch of talented guys up front, and if you've got four guys and a couple more coming in behind them in a wave or two, it's probably going to be challenging if you're Spencer Rattler to be able to drop back and find Xavier Leggett running a dig route or dragging across the middle of the field and all that. So yeah, I agree. They're going to have to be able to run the ball better against Clemson than they did last Saturday for sure.
Yeah, I don't think that it's a yardage marker, though, right? I mean, do y'all? Like, I don't think that they have to. I think Clemson gives up 121 yards per game, which is really, you know, pretty darn good, right? But I don't think that it's like, well, they need to run for 100. I just think they need to be able to run when they need to run. Like, if it's third and one or it's fourth and one on Clemson's 40-yard line and you're in that trap zone, like, you've got to be able to get a yard or two to be able to move the football and at least be able to do some things off of that. That's how I consider this running game being successful, not necessarily a yardage marker.
Or being able to get, you know, at least positive yards on early downs, so that way you're looking at third and five or third and six as opposed to third and 10 or third and 11.
Because yeah, don't get behind the sticks in the run game.
Yeah, that's yourself in obvious positions, right?
Yeah.
And it's going to be tough. Good news is, I mean, Amari and Hampton sort of went off last week against Clemson. John, did you guys notice that in that game? He fumbled inside the one, but yeah. I mean, he had a big couple of big long runs, and they did not necessarily bottle him up. And he's a great back, don't get me wrong. But Mario Anderson needs to run like he always does, like his life depends on it, and break some tackles and churn out that tough yard. I feel bad for him because he hadn't had a lot of room the last couple of weeks. And I don't know, based on what Beamer said, if he's 100% right now. He's probably banged up like everybody else, but is this time of year. But it'll be important to get the run game going somehow, in this football game.
Yeah, the Lenore Sellers package we saw last week, I'd be interested to see how that continues to play a part in this game plan, or how that'll play a part in this game plan. Because aside from that one play by the goal line where they got penalized, they were able to get get some positive yards. They were able to do a little bit, so you probably feel better about calling that on third and two than you would third and eight, right?
Yeah, it got a little cattywampus when he went in the other day, but and I like that word, cattywampus.
That's a good word.
He was effective. I mean, it's just two carries, 9 yards. I mean, that's a guy that, you know, like Shane said, that package, you probably do need that package some, you know. Well, and he's a guy, too, that if he breaks a couple tackles, the band's playing. So
let me ask you all this, though. So Spencer is departing for the NFL. I believe he's accepted his Senior Bowl invite to play in the Reese's game down there in Mobile. If Lenoris plays this week and for some reason Spencer doesn't play in the bowl game, who's the quarterback? Because that would – I mean, he could play, but it would burn a red shirt.
Mm-mm. You get a waiver now for bowls.
No, you don't. That was a one-year waiver. I was looking at this the other day. Last year, they have not issued a waiver moving forward. It was just a one-year waiver.
I have a feeling that here in about a week or two, once the portal opens back up and some bowl teams are trying to piece together two deep depth charts, that folks are going to be asking for waivers. I think it should be a permanent thing because of the portal. I mean, if the portal's around, that should be around too, because guys are going to be leaving their teams.
Yeah, wasn't it last year, though? The 1 year was last year, right?
It was last year. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, yep. So they're going to have the same issue this year. So, yeah, it's maybe they'll get the it.
Yeah.
Even if they don't, I'm still starting in Lenore Sellers in the bowl game, getting a start on next year, man. I'm still going to do it. And now look, depending on who you play, I mean, like Luke Doty, you could compete with Luke Doty. I don't know that Spencer's going to necessarily skip the bowl, though. I mean, I think it's on the table that he still plays. I personally think
he will play.
I think you can do Senior Bowl at a bowl game, depending on when the bowl is. So I'm pretty sure
you can do it. Not until February.
Yeah, I'm sure you could do both. So, but
when they put Sellers in this week, I was like, oh, this must mean Doty. I mean, not Doty, but Spencer's playing in the bowl game. We're all in for next week because Sellers is not going to play this week and not next week. That was my other thing.
Yeah.
My understanding is he will
beat his arm.
Yeah. Especially if they head up to the Liberty Bowl or the Music City Bowl or whatever they did. Nice to be a tough challenge whoever they get up there. That would create an interesting scenario. All right, Hale, the Clemson defense, as we well know, is that front seven is pretty good. Anything that has been employed the last couple of weeks or deployed on the offensive side of the football, you know, that we've seen some different formations. This past week, we saw some scenarios where you saw Xavier Leggett in there taking a couple of carries, very similar to what Jaheim Bell did last season for Carolina. Trey Knox looked good. It was good to see him in there and healthy this week and playing well. But we've seen a couple of different things that Dowell has kind of rolled out from an offensive standpoint the last couple of weeks. What would you make of that with the Tigers coming in the defensive challenge that we know that they'll bring with them?
I would have to imagine that South Carolina's offense is going to pull out all the stops, if you will. It's one of those matchups where you know that it's going to be tough to get whatever you want. Like you're going to have to probably run a few trick plays. You're going to have to try to use some things that you haven't gone to before and they haven't had a chance to prepare for. So I do think there will be plenty, like there's probably some bread and butter type of stuff that they know they're going to want to go to, whether it's Leggett or whoever else. I mean, we've seen some of the two tight end stuff be effective. Nick Harbor's had a place within this offense. Like I think we'll see some of those main players like doing things that we've seen them do all season. Amarian Brown being involved, but I would venture a guess that there's going to be some sort of a curveball or two mixed in along the way, and whether or not they work, that's maybe it's a difference in the game. I mean, the T formation play with Juju last year is a great example. If they don't hit that play, which is what, a fourth down, and South Carolina's in their own territory. If they don't hit that play, it's an incompletion, probably lose that game. And now I don't know that they necessarily need to be that ballsy with some of the stuff I'm kind of referring to, but you got to be willing to empty the clip in a game where your offense is facing a tough defense like Clemson's. I mean, going back to what we were talking about with the run game, they're going to have to continue to be creative that way and try to keep that group off balance and guessing and seeing some things that maybe they hadn't seen before.
I think there's 21 seniors that will walk tomorrow night. That list does include guys like Mario Anderson, although we know he has an extra year of eligibility, and it's TBD as to whether he will return or not. But this group here at Hale, if they for some reason fall short on Saturday night, how will we look back? You know, Xavier Leggett, Spencer Rattler. I mean, there's DeCarrion Joyner. I mean, my gosh, like there are so many guys who I feel like are blue collar dudes in that locker room that have just worked really hard and committed themselves to Gamecock football under Coach Beamer to get things going back in the right direction. Again, we might see some of these guys still next year, but they will at least get recognized in case they do not return to Columbia, South Carolina. And a lot of those guys, like Xavier Leggett, not a really highly recruited kid out of Mullins. He's one of the best, if not the best, receiver in the country. Mario Anderson goes to Newberry, comes to South Carolina. I mean, there are these stories. DeCarrion Joyner could have easily left and gone somewhere else for greener pastures to do whatever he wanted to do. And here he is. So a lot of amazing stories. How will we, in time, in your mind, as it stands today, view this group and what they've meant to this program?
Or a guy like Marcellus Dial, who committed to the old staff as a junior college cornerback and didn't even get to play his sophomore season at Georgia Military because of COVID. And
great point.
Stayed committed to the new staff and signed and has become a starter over the last year and a half and been a really good player. And there are others. I mean, it's a very non-traditional time right now in college football. Like, there are guys like Jordan Strawn who have been here for 3 years since the start of this coaching tenure or the Shane Beamer era. He's a senior. He's done after this year. And there are obviously quite a few others, but I don't know if I could sit here and say how they should be remembered or how they will be remembered, because that's more for the fans, I guess. But you know, when I look at some of these individuals, like those two I just named, and Leggett and Joyner, like you said, JB, and I just kind of think of some of the little things that I remember from over the years, like Leggett when he came in or he was getting recruited, and that former staff offered him as a gray shirt. Like, he wasn't even supposed to sign in that 2019 class or whatever it was. Then that Friday of the early signing period, his national letter of intent was signed and sent in, and it was kind of unexpected because he was supposed to gray shirt, and then they decided to go ahead and sign him, and they bring him in with a couple of other higher rated recruits and Kevion Mullins, and I can't even remember who else it was, but you know, he all of a sudden towards the end of the season, Leggett's the one who's playing. And he fights through all the issues he had over the year with actually catching the football, and now he's having this incredible season. Then Joyner, with all that he's done, and you know, he was one of the best is one of the best high school football players in the state of South Carolina, in the history of the state of South Carolina
ever. Yeah,
look at the numbers. Took his team to a state championship as a sophomore, and he's been an ambassador for the university ever since he's been here, and done all played all kinds of positions and done all sorts of stuff. And really, I'm, you know, I hate to say I'm pulling for him to be able to play on Saturday, but it would be really cool for him to be able to go out there one more time and step on that field at Williams-Brice.
Yeah. I mean, it's really, it's a list of guys who I think that, you know, they've developed. They've like Spencer Rattler taking a risk and coming to South Carolina. And yeah, you brought up Marcellus Style. It's a blue collar list of kids. There's no doubt about that. And they all have just a really unique path to getting here. This is if you're going to be there Saturday night, we mentioned it yesterday, we'll mention it every day till we get to the game. Please go in as soon as you can and don't miss this, because these guys deserve as loud of an ovation as they could possibly imagine. All right, we'll let you run, Hale. Final quick keys to the game. Looking at this matchup this weekend, anything just at the top of your mind that you're anxious to see how well the Gamecocks perform in that section on Saturday?
The defense has to keep playing well. You know, it kind of started at A&M when they rolled out that 3-3-5, and we saw some flashes of good things, and it felt like we weren't going to ever see that from this defense in 2023. The Jacksonville State game was obviously concerning with what they were giving up on the ground, but they finally broke the seal and got some turnovers. And, you know, it was just Vanderbilt a week later, but they really flexed on those guys and kept getting turnovers and carried it over to last weekend against Kentucky. And you know, like I said at the beginning of the month, this thing was going to build and progressively get harder as the month played out. And Clemson's offense, while it's had its issues, that they can still run the football very well. And so that's where it's going to start, being able to limit Will Shipley and Phil Moffa as best they can. Cade Klubnik can run too. He's very capable that way. So if they can somehow figure out a way to limit those guys as best they can, not give up a bunch of big plays, I'd like South Carolina's chances to win the game. But yeah, they're going to have to run the ball better offensively and give Spencer Rattler some time to do his thing as well. So it's cliche and probably can say it every week, but it's going to start up front on both sides of the ball.
Tigers are 7-point favorites over the Gamecocks. Kickoff 7:30 Saturday night on the SEC Network. Hale, thanks for all you do. We're very thankful for you, and we hope you have a wonderful Thanksgiving ahead of covering this weekend's ball game.
Boys, I always enjoy our time here on Tuesdays, and everyone who tunes in live and listens later on the podcasts, however they digest their podcast. Thank y'all as well. Always appreciate the feedback from everyone who tunes in. Yeah, everyone.
Hey, favorite Thanksgiving side?
Oh, so my mom makes this like cornbread dressing type of deal. It's not stuffing. It's she fixes it in a pan and bakes it, and it's phenomenal. That is my favorite Thanksgiving side.
And you're
I like her style. Mom, that's how we do it too.
Mm-hmm. Nice.
Mom's making that this year. Is Thanksgiving at your house or mom's house?
My wife and I are going to my parents' house tomorrow. I'm going to celebrate with them and one of my aunts. Then Thursday we're going to come back to Columbia and hang out with her, a lot of folks from her family here in town. So we're doing two Thanksgivings.
That's fantastic. Well, happy Thanksgiving, man. We really appreciate you.
Same to y'all. Be good.
There you go. Hale McGranahan.
Thanks, Hale.
BigSpur.com. All right, we are like way past due for a break. So we'll slide into that. We are served by Chicken Cock Whiskey. Make sure you get it, because tomorrow's the last day to do it, or else you can't get it on Thursday. You know, it's Thanksgiving. Goes great with turkey, I might add. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
The preferred sign partner of Gamecock Athletics is Signorama Columbia, and they should be yours too. A full-service sign company that handles design, production, install, and service, Signorama Columbia has helped to bring to life the perfect vision for so many all across South Carolina. Owned and operated by proud Gamecock alumni, they can handle all types of signage, including interior and exterior, vehicle graphics, and more. Go to signorama.com and find the West Columbia location, or call them at 803-407-9284. Bring your brand to life with Signorama Columbia, and go Gamecocks.
Charleston Fitness Equipment is keeping South Carolina in shape. Clients have come from all over the Palmetto State to find that one piece of equipment that they enjoy that keeps them looking and feeling good. Whether it's a home rower, treadmill, elliptical, free weights, a home gym, or something else, Charleston Fitness Equipment keeps the mirror smiling back at you. Get in shape like the Gamecocks do. visit charlestonfitnessequipment.com. Gamecock owned and operated and proud partners of Inside the Gamecocks, the show.
Cool Joe here. And when I'm not eating average jambalaya or celebrating endless summer in Destin, I like to eat pimento cheese straight out the bucket. Mmm. And the only pimento cheese I like to eat is from Nana's Porch. It's award-winning. It'll melt in your mouth. It's good on a cracker. It's good in a bowl. It's good on a piece of bread. Also, don't forget, Nana's Porch has a hell of a food truck. It's award-winning as well, and they're here for all of your catering needs. So get online, nanasporch.com. It's mm-mm good. Coach O signing off. Endless summer. Go Tiger.
For chicken cock, we get a medium to medium plus toast. The char level, we use a number 3 level char. If you char too deep, you start burning away some of those flavor components that you just created. If you just char a barrel and you don't toast it, you're going to create some of those flavors just on a thin layer just inside the char, but not the actual depth and full extent of flavors that you're going to get if you toast it properly. All those elements, that's exactly what they do. They boil down to great flavor.
If you're in the real estate market in the Lowcountry or even in the Midlands, please contact me, JB, with Coast to Coast Realty SC. Go Gamecocks.
This break is presented by Billy G's Carolina Barbecue, the state newspaper's 2023 winner for Best Catering, Best Barbecue, and Best Food Truck. Visit BillyG'sCarolinaBarbecue.com for all of your catering needs.
Ladies and gentlemen, here it is.
Thunder, feel the thunder. Lightning and the thunder. Thunder, thunder, feel the thunder. Lightning and the thunder. Thunder, thunder, feel the thunder. Lightning and the thunder.
Well, Mad Dog, 80,000 people sure would like to see a few of those plays from one of the greatest receivers to ever do it here at South Carolina. Xavier Leggett has just had an amazing, amazing year. Guys, I hope and pray that Saturday night is more of the same times a million for Spencer Rattler and Xavier Leggett. It's their night. You know, it's their night. And I sure hope that that those guys go out there and connect a lot and often and makes it a special, special evening in the Midlands for a lot of Gamecock fans.
Yeah, it really is. It's interesting. This team, you know, 2-6 coming out of a miserable October. But it seems like the fan base really connects with these guys for whatever reason. You know, there's some teams you feel a bit more detached from, but this team has just kind of captured the, I don't know, the not just hearts and minds, that's so cliche, but like really just the entire spirit of the fan base. Like we've been on a roller coaster with this team, and I think it's brought us all kind of a little closer to them, if you will.
That's a really interesting comment. I agree wholeheartedly. Well, look, I'll tell you, I think I know why. I keep saying this term, blue collar, and that's a lot of how Shane is, you know, how he's kind of built this. And JC, you know better than I do. I'd certainly know, you know, enough of those guys in there to be qualified to say this. But, you know, it is a blue collar staff, and every team's going to have like a handful of dudes that you're just like, yeah, whatever. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I wouldn't really associate myself with that guy except for he wears our school colors. But this team's got, I would say about 99.5% of kids that you'd want to hire when you know, if you had to fill a job. We've gotten to meet a lot of them. And I think that, that's what, to your point, Phil, you're talking about Xavier and talking about Spencer. those guys, like, you feel like they're kind of us. Now, I have no doubts that their NIL deals are more than mine. So we're not equals there. But I mean, like, when it comes to just feeling like you've got a connection with somebody who understands why I'm in the stands to watch you play, and they get that. You know, Xavier Leggett, his story is from, you know, being from Mullins, you know, didn't really come from anything, right? Didn't come from anything. And look at what he's turned into. I mean, last year, guys, what did he have, 178 yards receiving last year? And then all of a sudden, he's maybe the best wide receiver in college football. Spencer Rattler was a dude that all we knew about him was what we had seen on TV and what we had heard through the media, and it portrayed him very negatively. But we knew he could play. And then when he came to South Carolina, we all discovered pretty quickly, boy, there's a lot more to this kid than just being able to throw the rock 60, 70 yards down the field. Pretty darn accurately, by the way. You watch him on the sidelines, and he is the ultimate team builder as a quarterback over there. He takes all the blame. He's on the defense. He's in the defensive meetings. He's in the offensive meetings. He's doing everything that he possibly can. And we see that, because if J.C. Sherbert was the quarterback in South Carolina, you feel like you'd be doing that. I'd be doing that. Phil, you'd be doing that. All these people in this chat. So there's something to relate to there. Like, they care like we care. And I think that's where a lot of that comes from. And it's been really, really unbelievable to watch.
Yeah, this is Spencer Rattler has had a tremendous season, all things considered. And, you know, I read some comment earlier in the chat box that, you know, move on to Lenore Sellers because Sellers doesn't lock on to his receiver. I think it was Saturday Night Lights that said this. I'm like, what? I don't know what quarter. I don't know where you went to quarterback school or what quarterback you're watching. Right. If Spencer was locking on to his receivers right now, he'd probably have about 17 interceptions this year. Last time I checked, he had 7, and most of those are balls that slip out of his hand. So let's not. Lenore's is good at going through his progressions. Don't get me wrong, but good God. I mean, what are you watching if you think Spencer stares his receivers down? Please. You know, I saw another tweet today. I probably should not even read into this, where, you know, Shane Beamer's just nothing but mediocre and blah, 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 blah. Well, you have to understand this. This is a tough season, challenging season for any head coach because of things that are out of his control. I mean, namely the injuries and the way the schedule set up. You know, they weren't going to sit there and move the North Carolina game or cancel the North Carolina game. Nobody knew Missouri was going to be a top 10 team. Nobody knew there were going to be 12 injuries on the offensive line in a year where they could not have any. Let me just stress that. Heading into this season, people always get on us about what we're talking about. Oh, you guys just mislead us in the preseason. One thing we did hammer home in the preseason all summer, they cannot have injuries on the offensive line. And from the first play of the North Carolina game on, it's a mash unit. And they get something solved, like in Florida, oh, boom, Vershawn Lee goes down. None of those guys are even really playing at 100% right now. Okay, let's be clear about that too. So I don't know how that relates to a coach embracing our fan base, embracing mediocrity. To me, the majority of the fan base is realistic and understands. I mean, why else would you have that atmosphere? I mean, nobody showed up because Darude was playing, dudes. All right? Nobody came because of Darude. They came because it was a night game. It was a big game. It was Kentucky. It was Carolina. Darude was a bonus for sure.
Yeah.
But that atmosphere, with or without Darude, that could be like a U2 parody, with or without Darude, with or without Darude.
But I mean, that's a good
anyway. Point. No,
like, but yeah, look, do it, but
yeah, the freaking fans, the majority of the fan base gets it, and I get it too. I mean, it's just one of those things. And here's another thing why I think people really like this team is, number one, they never quit, and I've seen Carolina teams quit. Number two, a lot of the quote-unquote heroes outside of Spencer Rattler, who obviously is from metropolitan Phoenix, are from small towns in South Carolina that weren't very highly recruited. Yep. Look on the offense. You got Josh. I mean, I know Trey Knox has made his share of plays, but Josh Simon's made these inspirational plays where he breaks tackles and keeps going and it's tough and all that. That kid went, he had no offers but Western Kentucky coming out of school in Sumter, Crestwood, and now he's back. Mario Anderson, I don't need to say anything else about him. Xavier Leggett from Mullins, I don't say anything else about him. You know, Omega Blake from Rock Hill has made some plays. You know, you've got a good core of in-state guys, the safeties, Nick and DQ back there. You know, you've got some guys.
Marcellus and OD.
The defense, Taka Hemingway has made. Taka Hemingway, the last month of the season, he sort of disappeared for the season as far as like, but he's making his Taka plays. He's getting in, tipping passes, catching interceptions. TJ Sanders from Marion. You know, and that's why this program is always going to be built on in-state talent. And it's been proven through the years there are damn good players in this state, regardless of what kind of star rating they have. Okay? They are damn good players. In Carolina, if you want to know what they kind of have been missing the last few years, there was a period there where they didn't – there were some that they didn't get. Egram Dawkins, Boone, the linebacker at Hilton Head, that I don't even – we'll ever want to count that guy's kids as in-state at all. That went to Notre Dame. I mean, you know, there are players from this state, you know, that went elsewhere, you know. But I think that still means something at the University of South Carolina, and I think it always will. I don't think you're ever going to see, no matter how good this program gets, you know, South Carolina stop recruiting the state. And even guys that are like three-star guys. You know, I mean, look at Judge Collier on the field the other night as a true freshman. There's your next Rock Hill defensive back. Hey, big surprise, right?
Yeah.
No, so I think all those things factor in.
Well, I agree with that. I mean, first of all, to your point just a minute ago, you can never stop recruiting the state of South Carolina, because if you do, you lose. Like, this program cannot win without signing the best players to come out of the Palmetto State. It just can't. It's been proven over the years. And with at least with this staff in place, they will not stop doing that because they understand what it means. All you got to do is go look at the recruiting boards and figure that out pretty quickly. But, you know, I also think, too, like, there's, you know, this fan base, Phil, that was a great, excellent point that you made about how people connect. Like, this, everybody wants more than 6-6 or 5-7 or 8-5 or 7-6 or whatever. You know, Coach Spurrier came along and really created something that didn't exist around here, which were expectations. And you could even honestly make the argument that those are unrealistic expectations to go win 11 games every single year. Now, I hope I'm proven wrong, but it's never happened before, and it hasn't happened since. So it's hard to sit here. I mean, is it the Gamecock men's basketball program, is that supposed to be – are they supposed to be in the Final Four every year? You know, Is the baseball team, although some people insist on this, are they supposed to be in the College World Series every year? That's impossible. You know, and so being an 11-win team every year, that expectation really should not exist. Now, I hope they get to a point where that expectation should exist. I do. But they're not there. And so this program always – you know, the fans, you know, are always looking for a reason to hope and to believe. And I think a lot of that does come to your point, JC, and to your point, Phil, from having these kids that we've watched play high school ball. They maybe grew up in our town or a town near us or whatever it is. So it's easy to pull for them. And then, you know, let's just say what it is. They're just good kids. Like, they're just good kids. I mean, Xavier Leggett is just a good kid. Spencer Rattler is just a good kid. We have all this access now, right? And you get to see the lives of these kids. Like, back when I was growing up, JC, when you were growing up, Phil, when you were growing up, The only thing we got to see from the kids that ran into that ballpark were when they ran into that ballpark and when they played and then when they ran back out. We didn't get to, you know, you'd see an interview here and there. You might read something in the newspaper and you might hear something on the radio, right? But were y'all on their Twitter accounts in 1995? Nope. Were you on their Facebook page? So, you know, we didn't get to see all that. We didn't know anything about them. They were just kids in uniforms. And now we get to see all that. And this group is a good group. And we get to see who they really are. And I think there's a lot that we all understand about them as people. So, you know, it also helps when you're just a really good freaking football player. It's easy to connect with a guy when he's out there catching 1,500 yards worth of passes every year and another guy who's throwing for 3,500 yards worth of passes. Pretty easy to fall in love with those type guys too.
Yeah, or anybody who's obviously out there busting their ass, you know? I mean, even in the darkest of times, that's, you know, because it's like, you know, like JC tells us, you know, what Derek Moore's philosophy is that, you know, this game is an allegory of life. I mean, you know, you're going to get pushed back. You got to keep moving. Like, you know, one of my favorite quotes is not how hard you can get hit. Or it's not, you know, it's how many times you can come back from it. You know, it's like, it's, of course, my mind just blanked on the whole Rocky quote there. My wife would kill me.
Yeah, it's not how hard you get hit. It's how hard you can get hit and get up and keep moving. Keep
moving forward.
That's what winning is. That's how winning is done. That's what cowards do. That ain't you.
Well, that's what it is. I think it's just it makes it related. It makes the silly game that we watch and you know follow like ravenous beasts actually relatable to you know the struggles that we all have in our own lives.
Yeah. Look, and I here's and the then, thing. This started under Steve Spurrier because when Spurrier took over, I think we'd all agree there needed to be some house cleaning, right? Mm-hmm. I was asked today what my most disappointing Carolina Clemson game has been. It's the fight year. Because then what happened after that where guys just had such little respect for the uniform they put on. They went and stole laptop computers, and Spurrier had to kick a bunch of guys talent-wise. They were good, talented players. Had to kick them off, right? And that was disgusting to me. And well, as time went on, he kind of cleaned it up, you know, and it almost ended up they had too many good people by the end of his tenure. And then Muschamp recruited good kids into this program. I think Will kind of felt like that was kind of going to be the secret. And, he, you know, you mentioned blue collar. That's what he said his first press conference, blue collar overachieving outfit. So, and Beamer's continued that. So we'll see. I agree with all that. I do think that, you know, I do think this season has been a down season, but I also encourage everyone to understand the reality of it. And to understand that there were just some things this year that were out of everybody's control. And you can't blame coaching, and you can't blame the players. I know everybody wants somebody to blame. Hell, me too. But sometimes you just got to say it is what it is and move forward, win or lose this weekend.
It is the end of the hour. We are powered by Electric Bikes of Charleston, electricbikescharleston.com. They are fired up and ready to go for the Christmas season. So if you or someone you know in your family, maybe your children, maybe your spouse, maybe someone else that is looking for one of the neatest things out there, these electric bikes, you don't have to have it in pedal assist mode. You can actually pedal if you want, or you can just ride around and drink chicken cock and let it go for you. Either way, it's the best of both worlds. You don't have to live in Charleston either. Electricbikescharleston.com. Michelle, if you're watching, we literally love you. Thank you for everything that you do for us and everybody else out there, and happy holidays. All right, Mike Morgan is in today because we're off Thursday, so don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
Hey folks, it's JB, and as we all know, it's football season. My favorite place to shop for myself and the family is Gamecock Traditions in Lexington. They have the widest selection of Gamecocks attire, plus all the cool accessories for tailgating, cooking, kids, shoes, hats, and so much more. Most importantly for me, you can order online at GamecockTraditions.com and it's shipped timely to your door. I've been shopping here for years and I hope you will too. Order online right now on the Chief Sports app. Go Gamecocks!
Tony Pope State Farm is your go-to agent anywhere in South Carolina, North Carolina, or Georgia for the service you deserve at the price you want. So try combining your home, life, auto, and or small business insurance today. Tony Pope State Farm has been in business for more than 30 years and can handle anything you need in the tri-state area. 843-851-2222 or visit TonyPope.com today. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
If you're on Medicare currently or approaching eligibility, it's time to enroll in a Medicare plan that meets your needs. Palmetto Medicare is here to help you through the process. Palmetto Medicare's owner, Brian Spencer, and his team of experts are here to assist you. Learn about the benefits and enroll in the plan that will cover as many of your medical costs as possible. Some of the advantages of Medicare health plans may include variety of plan choices, increased benefits, lower premiums, and more. Give Palmetto Medicare a call to discuss your insurance and help get the exact coverage for your needs today.
Nana's Porch, nanasporch.com. At Nana's Porch, they cater weddings, parties, and all kinds of special events. Their meals are served buffet style. In seconds, they're encouraged. Plus, they can bring their mobile food unit to bring on-site and serve your guests as a unique alternative for your catering needs. Inquire about rentals as well. nanasporch.com. Find them on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. 336-259-7550.
South Carolinians, this message is for you, as well as for people in Georgia, Florida, and Tennessee. If you think you may need work done to your roof or a new roof altogether, there's one simple name to remember: Elite Roofing and Restoration. South Carolina native Jeremy Johnson has been helping people in the South make sure they have the very best people checking on and building new roofs for over 25 years. Fully licensed, bonded, and insured, they provide the best service possible. Call or email today, 678-781-1998. That's 678-781-1998, or you can go to EliteRoofingGA.com. Schedule a no-hassle, free inspection today. Wind damage, hail damage, or just wear and tear. Don't settle for second best. Let Jeremy Johnson and Elite Roofing and Restoration take care of it all for you today.
The State Farm Personal Price Plan helps you create an affordable price just for you.
Contact local agent Gary Patterson for your personal price plan today.
This holiday season, you can give a gift like never before. Hey guys, it's JB. Rescues in Resin produces custom designed wood and resin products. From tables to wall art, coasters to cutting boards, and pretty much anything you can dream. Proud Gamecocks and veteran owned, Dustin and Tabitha are creating products that will blow your family and friends away when they take the wrapping paper off this Christmas. Check them out in the Chiefs Sports app now to get your custom order in before it's too late. Rescues and Resin are also proud supporters of Carolina Rise and proud partners of the Chiefs Sports Network. Rescues and Resin at gmail.com or in the Chiefs Sports app is where you can find them. Change your gift-giving game today by ordering a custom design through our friends Tabitha and Dustin and Rescues and Resin.
My company is Billy G's Carolina Barbecue. We are based in Columbia, South Carolina, and we have two lines of sauces and a spice rub. I mean, when people try our product, they know it's a gourmet product, and it can go on any type of food. It's not surprisingly delicious. It's expectedly delicious.
The State Farm Personal Price Plan helps you create an affordable price just for you.
Contact local agent Gary Patterson for your personal price plan today.
Thank you.
Billy G's Carolina Barbecue presents the national anthem every day here on Inside the Gamecocks, the show. Welcome back. The Palmetto Cocktail pregame party is this Friday night. Too Much Sylvia will be playing. Barbecue and hors d'oeuvres will be served. Have a cocktail 2, 10, or 12 the night before Clemson and Carolina kickoff at the Rockbridge Club in Forest Acres. If you've got the Chief Sports app downloaded, it's easy. You just click it and then click the party button and you can buy your tickets. And we'll see you there on Friday night at the Palmetto Cocktail pregame party presented by Billy G's Carolina Barbecue. Make sure you do bring some cash with you, as there will be a cash bar after those couple of drink tickets run out. If any of you are like me, you'll need cash because two is probably not going to do it on the rivalry weekend. Can't wait to see you again. Click the party button on the app to attend the Palmetto Cocktail pregame party in Forest Acres on Friday night. Phil, JB, JC, and the golden tones of the great Mike Morgan back on the East Coast after spending time on the left coast calling football for that team they call the 49ers. He was sending us photos of him and Debo and Brock Purdy. Let's see, who else did you hang out with out there? I think I saw.
I didn't hang out with him, but Javon Kinlaw made a couple of tackles in that game. He's a backup now, former first-round pick.
San Fran. Who else is in San Fran? Did you get to meet any of the cast of Full House?
No, I did see Steph Curry. I went to the Warriors game on Saturday night, and it was like a – I felt like I was back doing an SEC basketball game.
Hey, Coach. Sorry, I didn't realize, I didn't realize you were in the in his restaurant. Hey, Steve. Good to see you.
Shoot. Mike Morgan was here.
Yeah. That was awesome. I'm not going to lie.
You had week, man. Because that was – you called the Florida State basketball game, too, last Friday.
Friday night, yeah. So went straight from Gainesville to San Francisco, called 49ers Bucks Sunday, and then on the plane ride back yesterday – and look, everybody's got their own plane issues, and I choose Delta not just because I'm in Atlanta, but overall they've been good to me, relatively speaking. But there were some issues. So what should have been a long trip anyway, going from coast to coast, it made it a lot longer. You don't give people 15 minutes to connect into the Atlanta airport from one concourse to three concourses down. That means you got to go down the escalator on the train, up two concourses, back up an escalator. And then mine was C49. So I'm like OJ in the Hertz commercial with my luggage going from the epicenter of that concourse to the very last gate. And that might be, I don't know, a half a mile. And I technically was 4 minutes before the flight took off. Now, because I'm in Kentucky now. I'm with my wife's family for Thanksgiving, and then I've got the Wildcats Friday night against Marshall. And so I'm sprinting, and I get there 4 minutes before the flight takes off. And then, yeah, it's story time with Uncle Mike. I got a few for you folks. So gather around, kids. Gather around, kids. We're coming in off the top rope with some hot stories here, fresh off the presses. So I get there 4 minutes before the plane is supposed to take off, but by then they lock the gates. That's an FAA rule. That's not a Delta rule. You cannot get on the plane. I think it's at least a 10-minute gap there. So now I got 4 hours to kill before the next flight. So I go in the old Sky Lounge and hang out there and get some work done. But the part of the moral of this story, and we'll get to Steve and everything else, but part of the moral of the story is, as I'm on that cross-country flight from San Fran to Atlanta, I had a lot of choices. I had a lot of entertainment choices. You know, you got the TV screen there. I've got podcasts that I listen to that I've downloaded. And I look at the clock and I said, You know what? I need to check out the burgeoning empire that is the Chief Sports Network and Inside the Gamecocks, which, much like the JC5 on JC and Morgan, it really does dictate and set the morale of a great nation. So I went ahead and I tuned in, and I was thoroughly entertained. That that knocked off like 2 hours of my, I didn't get a chance to hear all three. It knocked off about 2 hours of entertainment options for me, helped the flight go quicker. I enjoyed the give and take, the conversation. It was very nice, made for a faster ride. So I feel like even though I'm parachuting in here today, I was already a part of this program as just a fan yesterday. And I thank you all for entertaining me during that flight. Help the peanuts go down much better.
Did my mic sound okay, Mike?
JC, you know we go back a ways. You know I come from a place of love. You've got the right microphone, so you sound better. You sound better. So this has been an ongoing process, you know, and we're getting JC, who's much more technical savvy than I am, but on the microphone kick, you had to get out of that whatever that little Empire Strikes Back little globe you had where you like you take the lifesaber and try to stab it while it's shooting missiles at you.
Snowball, yeah.
Yeah, the snowball. Yeah, you had the snowball mic. And that wasn't good. So now you got a good mic, but you need to get it closer to your mouth and farther away from your keys, because when you pound that keyboard, brother, it is, I mean, you've got the loudest keystroke in the history of keyboards.
Yeah, well, yeah. Nobody complained in the office, but they were like, oh, JC's are typing away. You know, yeah. So it's,
you have a keyboard protector on it, or is that all alone?
It's all alone. Like the Elton John of keyboard typists, hammer away, you know, hammering style of piano.
The other thing, I
got to work at a place called Crocodile, like Crocodile Rocks, you know, that style of piano.
Oh, love Crocodile Rocks. That's an awesome spot.
Yeah. Unfortunately, it doesn't make music. It just makes noise. So
the other thing is, since we're a visual medium and we're out there for the people on YouTube and Facebook and Twitter that like to see our smiling faces, you have like this evil angle on your camera. And very often you're looking down, which is telling the audience that wants to love J.C. Sherbert, love the visual of J.C. Sherbert as much as they love the written J.C., the audio J.C., you're looking down, almost feels like you're not engaged. They teach you this in TV. You got to engage those people. So we need you to prop that angle at a different angle where it's not like you're just looking down at something on your desk and they just see the top of your head. They want to make eye contact. It's like that fine lady at the bar that's been staring you down all night, JC, back in your single days, back in your running days. You got to make eye contact with that girl. She's not going to give you her digits if you don't make a little eye contact.
You know?
I always liked it because it was like watching a zoo exhibit, right? You're just down there and the wild animals are kind of down below you, and you know, you don't want that. You want that 4-inch glass between you and that crazy gorilla that can just fly off the handle at any time.
It's no way to talk about any exes here. Look, we've all had our crazy moments in the dating world, but no, the mic does sound much better, JC. I did hear some key pounding. I did. It's just where you're positioning the mic, that's all. If you just move it up, I know you don't have a mic arm or stand. Like what I do, right now you folks can't see this at home, but I'm at my wife's house in Kentucky, and so I've got it in like a flower pot. Because if I just put it on the table, I'm going to be looking down like I was talking about, and you're going to hear every me shuffling papers and all that stuff.
Well, I've got it.
Look at this. This is what I have my mic in. I'm letting you all behind the scenes.
I've got this on a box for Manscaped, actually.
Wow, that's TMI. Woo!
Hey, I took advantage of the free shipping and all that good stuff. They were a sponsor long ago. Yeah. I took advantage of that. So, yeah, I got a box that hadn't opened yet. I guess it's some blades or some ointment or something. Ointment. Anyway, so I've got it sitting on top of this box with this tiny ass stand that went to the other mic, and it's difficult. I mean, you know, and I would blame my gut size for this, but my gut's actually comfortably fitting in. It's the table and the position of my monitor on my computer, because you know I got that big monitor.
I don't see it.
It's right below, right here we go, right off screen. Here we go.
See, there you go. Now, if you, that's a good mic. Okay, you got the sure mic. You're
I got the
next
one.
Level. We just got to put it up a little bit so the angle of your head is better, the sound of your voice is better without the background noise. Baby steps. We're getting there. It's going to sound awesome. There we go. Yeah.
There's nothing like doing this right in the middle of the show, you know. Right,
I'm sure every all our listeners are loving.
All right,
this,
well, we'll follow up on
we'll
that.
We'll figure
later.
This out later.
Gentlemen,
all right, so,
how are you? How's it going? So yeah, the real quick on this. Do you want me to tell the Spurrier story real quick?
Go for it. Yeah.
So I'm in town. We go to his. For those of you, let's see, Carolina would be at Florida next year. If you do make a road trip and you go to Gainesville, you got to go to Spurrier's restaurant. Now, the room we were in, you see all those helmets behind me, and for the radio audience that can't see it, it's a bunch of helmets relative to where Spurrier coached. There are a ton of Gamecock helmets and memorabilia in the restaurant, just not in this room where they put us. But you see the Redskin helmet, you see a high school helmet, I believe, and you see an SEC helmet, you see Gator helmets all over, and a Tampa Bay Bandits helmet, which is where he coached in the USFL. There's a ton of Gamecock memorabilia in there as well. And it's an unbelievable restaurant that is the guy that owns it owned the number one grossing Domino's pizza in the world when he worked there in Gainesville. And part of the secret was he had bought the phone number 352-something-something-something-or-other off a Baptist church. Why did he want that number? Because the number spelled out free beer. So if you're a college kid and you wanted to know how to order a pizza, you would type in 352 free beer. That's brilliant. So that same guy designed this. If you've ever been to a Shula's restaurant, a Shula's Steakhouse, think of a Shula's Steakhouse but 100 times better. It's just, and it is like the biggest Spurrier man cave known to mankind. So he came in with Jerry and we talked for about 20 minutes. I hadn't seen Steve in a while. He is still doesn't get around as well as he used to, I guess you could say, but he is, the mind is sharp as a tack. And we talked about Spencer Rattler. We talked about how in the hell did you win 11 games 3 years in a row in Columbia? And here's the thing about Steve is that he's the ultimate dichotomy in that he's overly arrogant yet self-deprecating, incredibly confident yet humble at the same time. So when you ask him a question like that, he says, well, Mike, we got lucky. Now, we know he didn't get lucky. He's a Hall of Fame coach, one of the best that ever do it. And when I asked him about Spencer Rattler, he's like, man, he's good. Shoot, he needs some help, but he's really, really good. That's when Steve says something that of that nature about a quarterback at any level, that is like, I hope that Spencer has gotten that message. I'm sure he has. That is like gold, because Steve doesn't just throw out meaningless compliments for giggles. He doesn't do that. Now, he'll tell you he ain't real good. Doesn't have the arm. Doesn't do this. Doesn't do that. In fact, he had more than a few critical words about some things I can't say. Not South Carolina. But anyway, it was. I just sounded like Steve there. But anyway, it was awesome, man. So I had a great filet. I had two sides and a dessert, and I had 20, 25 minutes with Steve and Jerry, his wife, who's still a sweetheart. And,
she's
you know,
the best.
She's like, she might as well be 35. She's just terrific. It was a highlight. I filled in on two of Steve's radio coaches' shows, and we talked about that too. That was back when they had it at Pulliam Ford off a two notch road. Mm-hmm. And you walked outside, and there were cop cars and hookers. That's where they did the show. Since then, they've moved it to a better part of town, to say the least. But all I would do during commercial breaks was just pick his brain. Steve, I remember when you were coaching the Bandits as a kid, Gary Anderson was one of my favorite players. Oh, yeah, I'm going to tell you about Gary. Steve, I remember when what you did at Duke, it'll never be done. Oh, yeah. And then I heard funny stories about Steve that I didn't know, because my partner on the NFL games is Brian Baldinger, who was an offensive lineman in the NFL for 12 years. Also, he played at Duke when they hired Steve. And I said, what was that like? He goes, Mike, it was crazy because he just got fired from Georgia Tech and he was out of work. And so Duke basically hired him as a walk-on coach. They didn't offer him money. He was on the street. And this is why Steve, to this very day, would vote Duke in the top 25. He's got a soft spot in his heart for Duke football, because Duke basically saved his career. Steve didn't know what he was going to do. He got fired at Georgia Tech for, I don't want to say what it was, but it was, I mean, it was somewhat harmless, but back then you just didn't do that as a coach in particular. So he was out on his rear end, and Duke took a flyer on him, and it didn't take long, as Brian would tell me, to immediately just show, like, the guy is a freaking offensive savant, and immediately started revolutionizing the way Duke did things offensively. Players were just in awe of Steve, even at Duke, before he took the Florida job. So it was just great. It was like a Steve Spurrier, you know, reality tour. And I guarantee you, he'll be watching. He'll be watching two games, right? I guess they're at the same time. But he still has a very soft spot in his heart for the Gamecocks. In fact, his wife, Jerry, told me, I mean, she still loves Columbia. They would love to open up a Spurrier's in Columbia, South Carolina. That's not off the table. I don't know if he'll actually do it, but at any rate. Somebody, Bill said no Florida. I did not know that. So you'll have to wait another time to go to Gainesville.
Yeah. It's Florida, Tennessee, Georgia, all off the schedule next season of football.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, Gamecocks don't see any of them next year. But they do see Kentucky, and they'll be going
Kentucky's
going
to be. Yeah.
Every year, the Wildcats.
They get Kentucky, Vandy on the road, Oklahoma on the road, Alabama on the road. At home, LSU comes to town, Ole Miss comes to town, Missouri comes to town, and A&M comes to town.
Well, thankfully, Jaden Daniels will be gone, but unfortunately, Jackson Dart will be back, so Ole Miss will be a headache to stop again next year.
Yeah. Well, in about 4 days, the Clemson Tigers come to town. Mike, we'll hit a quick timeout and get into the Gamecocks with you. We also have the CFP rankings coming out tonight. They're starting to get important now because some things are starting to kind of be finalized and figured out. So we'll talk a lot about that. And we'll get into some hoops a little bit later on. We'll talk some rivalry stuff, some Turkey Day stuff, and so on and so forth. You'll be here tomorrow as well. So we'll be able to have plenty of conversation with the Golden Tones of the great Mike Morgan. Nobody go anywhere. It is Power Hour presented by the very not handsome Brian Spencer with Palmetto Medicare. More on him and more on the Gamecocks when we return.
Down here in the South, we don't always see eye to eye. While our taste in college football teams or what sauce, if any, goes best on a rack of ribs or what to mix with our Dixie vodka might be up for debate, we can all agree there's nothing better than a Southern tailgate. And like our favorite college teams, our ingredients come from small towns and big cities. They're grown in Southern soil, are crafted by Southern hands, and proudly represent the South in our backyard and beyond. So raise a glass of Dixie Southern Vodka to celebrate being made in America and raised in the South.
Welcome to Palm Casual Patio Furniture. Because we are the factory, Palm Casual has the ability to offer the highest quality outdoor furniture paired with world-class service. Since 1979, our factory showrooms have done our best to make the buying process as easy as possible for our customers. Our understanding of the many factors that go into your decision has helped us create our 30-day trial period that increases the level of comfort our customers feel during the shopping experience. Visit us in Somerville and online at palmcasual.com. Gamecock owned and operated.
Michael Campbell arrived at South Carolina in 2003 after growing up in Virginia and was dubbed the Winchester Rifle by Gamecocks great Tommy Moody in the broadcast booth. He left in 2006 a legend, a career 315 hitter and 20th round draft pick of the San Diego Padres. Campbell was first all-time in games played at bats and triples, second all-time in hits with 299, singles and total bases, third all-time in doubles, top 10 in runs scored and RBI, and he hit 31 home runs in his career for the Gamecocks. Now he's passing his knowledge to the next generation through his business, Soup's Swing Shop. If your son or daughter wants to improve their game, Soup's Swing Shop offers virtual lessons. Mike will connect with you, diagnose your swing, and create a special game plan to help improve it. Call him at 859-414-8240. Email soupsswingshop@gmail.com or find them on social media and on the Chief Sports app. Soup Swing Shop. Play ball.
Welcome home. That's what the Gamecocks say, and so does the Barn Dough Company.
where they can build your dream home starting as low as $160 per square foot. If you live in the Carolinas, Georgia, or Tennessee, their turnkey process takes just 4 to 6 months on average and can be custom designed by size and details. Make your dream a reality. Visit thebarndominiumco.com. That's thebarndominiumco.com. The Barn Dough Company. Gamecock owned and operated.
Honestly, make an argument that that is the greatest quarterback to ever play at South Carolina. It is crazy the numbers he's put up in 2 years. Had he played four, every single record that's ever been broken or ever been set wouldn't be broken. They'd be like beyond shattered if you go look at the record books. I mean, it would be nuts. All those that have set those records that he is chasing down are four-year guys. And Spencer Rattler clearly has just been a two-year guy, although that dude in the chat box earlier said that it's time for him to move on so they can put Sellers in there because this is their GZ Jackson moment. Sellers will actually look around. And
now, JB, you get on Sherb.
Oh, no.
He gets worked up over somebody in chat row. Well, you're getting worked up over somebody in chat row.
Oh, I brought it up earlier. Don't get me wrong. I'm the one that brought it up. No, I mean, it's probably one of the dumbest things I've ever.
It was literally the dumbest comment of the year. Like, I mean, if somebody's going to win that award, that guy won it. Congratulations.
keep in mind, if Spencer's staring down receivers, any quarterback that stares down receivers is going to throw an abnormal number of interceptions. And Spencer's got seven, but that's good. I mean, in a lot of them have been like end of game situations, like Georgia or tip passes or miscommunicate. I mean, it's not like, he hadn't thrown a pick six, has he, this year? No.
No, relatively speaking, he's been remarkably efficient.
Yeah, when you're staring receivers down, they jump that route and they're gone. I mean, that's usually what happens to guys that have that tendency. Yeah. So
take a look at the all-time. I mean, I had a chance to do this a number of times to kind of put things in perspective, and I worked with people like Tom Price and kind of get further perspective on the history of the program. You know, you look at the history of Gamecock quarterbacking, you know, got one guy who threw 73 interceptions, which was a national record. You got another guy who threw a ton back when they didn't even throw the football a lot. Then you look at what Spencer Rattler has done with no offensive line, and Xavier Leggett is a terrific receiver, but there have been teams that certainly were equipped with more weapons than what Spencer has had to work with overall in his 2 years as a starter. So he's the most physically gifted receiver that ever has come, quarterback that's ever come through there. I don't think that's even much of a debate. Connor Shaw had the best career. I don't think that's a debate. And then you can start talking about guys like Tannehill and Jeff Grants and everybody else. But what you've seen here lately is as good as it's gotten in Columbia.
Yeah, it's the best we've ever seen. I mean, and you can really, Mike, he can capitalize on that this week by beating the Tigers for the second straight year and getting this team back into a bowl game. They couldn't have gotten into the bowl game without beating that team last week, but they had to do that last week with defense, and they did it for the first time all year. South Carolina's defense carried them to a win, and that's going to have to carry over one more week in the regular season, because you know this Clemson team, their defense is really good, and as it sits here today, if you give up 30 something points to the Tigers, Mike, I think the chances of them winning that game are very bleak.
Totally agree. I don't think Carolina is equipped to win a shootout against this defense, which Clemson still does have some dudes on defense. In order to win this game, and look, Clemson's favored for a reason, but it's still a winnable game in my eyes. You just have to minimize your blemishes, and we know what the blemishes are. They're on the defensive side, and they're on an offensive line which has vastly improved, right? We can all agree on that. They've kind of figured some things out. And defensively, I think you guys were talking about it yesterday. It looks like they've gotten a little more of a 3-3-5 look at times.
Yeah.
Kind of similar to Charlie Strong's successful defenses under Lou Holtz. When you don't have four dominating dudes on the D-line and you're not getting pressure with four dudes, you might as well go three and let the rest kind of pick up the slack. I think that might be some of the thinking there. But you need to minimize your blemishes, and then you need to have Rattler and Leggett go off. You need to have a running game continue to make progress, because you can't just be one-dimensional against Clemson. I don't think that's a good formula for success on Saturday. So, look, they're an underdog for a reason, but I do think it's a winnable game, especially being at home. I think the environment is going to be incredibly electric. Can't say enough about the fans. I got to say this. Kudos to the administration from Ray on down. I'm sure there's somebody in the marketing department. The Darud thing, I know some people might joke about that. First of all, I love that kind of music. I know that will come as a surprise to people, but I've always loved house and techno, and, again, I grew up on rap music, and that's just, I always like things with a beat. So that's my, but I realize that's not for everybody. You know, if you left it up to the old guard, they'd be playing Carolina Girls. You remember that catastrophe? Do you remember how that was an absolute embarrassment. And I remember being in the booth when they're playing it. And I know the people responsible for choosing that. People were booing not just the game when the team was losing. They were booing Carolina Girls. It was so awful. You don't play shag music at a football game. So I remember that. But you know, if the right prominent boosters and prominent people say, I want Carolina Girls, well, then some ADs and administration be like, well, whatever he wants, you give it to him. No, this is clearly a younger play, right? And if you go to football and basketball arenas around the SEC, and you have to appeal to your younger audience. You can't just alienate the students and the younger fans because it's what Joe Big Donor wants to play. So I thought one of the coolest things, I'm strolling through my Twitter timeline, and somebody posted the Darude. I can't remember exactly when they played it in game. They probably played it 100 times. But he's out there with his DJ, with his turntable or whatever, and he's pumping up the crowd, and they're playing it, and you've got the lights. I thought that was one of the coolest environment-type things at Williams-Brice that I've seen. I think it was awesome. So it might not have been for everybody, but I think it was a really good move. So whoever came up with that, kudos to you.
Well, you have to give them, all their propers, if you will, because that's one of the strongest recruiting tools you've got in South Carolina. It's one of the difference makers that you have in your hand at a place that's not going to, you know, just by name alone bring in top quality talent.
Yeah, and what happened this weekend number one, anybody that was in the ballpark enjoyed that. It really was neat. And I've seen every game in that stadium since basically 1990. So, you know, that was one of the neater moments I can remember too, Mike. Of course, nobody gives a crap unless you win the game. JC pointed this out earlier. You know, 80,000 people didn't run in there to see Darude. They were going in there to watch the Gamecocks play football. But to your point, the larger impact on that is what's happened since then. Barstool, ESPN, SEC Network, and other major entities have picked up this footage, and it has gone all across the country.
Yeah.
And you literally, based on that footage, could not find a better atmosphere on a Saturday night across college football. You just, no. It didn't exist. There was nothing that compared to that. And that's why you just pointed it out. That is why Darud was here. Yes, he was here to entertain. They were hoping they'd be able to take that and push it out in marketing, because you need to push it out in marketing. And they did it brilliantly.
You know all too well, Jamie, the power of marketing, right? I mean, you've got some of that in your blood. You're very meticulous. People that watch the show on the video feed, by the way, very good choice of Montgomery Gentry, My Town. That is one of the country songs that I'm all about. I love that song. Big prayers to the guy that got killed in the helicopter crash. I can't remember if it was Montgomery or Gentry.
It was Montgomery.
Montgomery, thank you.
Yeah.
Montgomery. But I do. I love that song. But, yeah, I mean, all those things, like somebody goes, well, it doesn't win you games. No, but, you know, everybody now is hiring people with all the money in college athletics to do what they call imaging and marketing and all these things that attract recruits and make it a cool spot. And that's where South Carolina has come a long way. Again, to go from Carolina girls playing shag music at a football game to what you have now, where you know it's good when everybody is copying it. I mean, I can't go to a football or basketball stadium and do a game where at some point I don't hear Darude. I don't hear a Sandstorm. They weren't copying shag music, but they did copy that. And I remember my last year doing basketball there was 2009, and that team beat Kentucky not once but twice, but at home at the Colonial Life Arena before 18,000 fans, when it was obvious that Carolina was going to win the game. Sam Muldrow went off, blocked Patrick Peterson, a future pro, like six times. Devin Downey did Devin Downey things. And during a timeout when Carolina was on a roll, they played Sandstorm. And I mean, the arena was so damn loud. And I took my headsets off. And I looked around, and honestly, I soaked it in, and I had goosebumps. And that doesn't happen often for me because, honestly, I've been there, done that. Like, I've seen the best of the best, and you kind of become a little bit numb to it. But I thought it was awesome. And that was back in 2009. And here we are in 2023, and it still is – it just works. It just works. So
it's got – yeah, and it's gotten bigger and bigger, too. I mean, because it started in 2009. I think most people trace its origins to Ole Miss Thursday night game in 2009 when they beat Houston Nutt's top four team. At the time, biggest, highest-ranked team Carolina had ever beaten at home. Now, that Ole Miss team finished 8-4. It was Jevon Snead and that crowd. But that was when it started. So, you know, allegedly, that's where they trace it to. But I remember that basketball season because that year, Mike, it was Horn's first year. I went to a lot of those games.
Mm-hmm.
It was a very promising season, a crappy schedule, and losing to Mississippi State in the tournament did them in. But at Ed Downey, it was at, I think, one of your calls, the Florida game, where they got it to Holmes down at the end.
The miracle play,
my buddy had courts. I was courtside most of the year, courtside.
Sam Frederick.
Yeah, Frederick, yeah. So, look, it was, it's been something that South Carolina's kind of picked up on, and it's worked for them, and it's a school that, you know, prior to 1983 when they started doing 2001, there just wasn't, you know, kind of, they always kind of hit the reset button. I mean, everybody thinks the fight song is Step to the Rear, the show tune, from Anti-Maine. What a musical. I was a theater major, and I would never equate that musical to a fight song. But anyway, they got the show tune, but the original fight song is this big, majestic Big Ten sounded thing. That thing, it's like a regular fight song. So I think around here, the point is we've reinvented. It's a very new program as far as its traditions go. I mean, you think about 2001; it's only 40 years old. Sandstorm's what, 15, 16. But the more things like that you have in a program that people love and they have an affinity for, I think the better your traditions are and the better your atmosphere is and
your brand.
You're going to compete. And your brand. Yeah. Yeah, your branding helps tremendously.
Well, look, you know, this is, you have to have forward thinking when you have a conversation about this. You know, it's 2023. In 2043, 2053, if they're still doing this, which I can't imagine at this point in time they wouldn't be, this is a tradition that's been around for a long time. It's a new tradition right now. But when you look around college football and you see all these traditions, you know, this school has this tradition and this school has this tradition. That's what makes it all so great, as we all well know. And then you look at your own brand or your own program sometimes and you say, well, we just don't have a lot of that. Well, this is how that gets started. It just takes time for it to be the established tradition. So in 30 years, this is an established tradition that's been around for a long time. Just like coming out to 2001. It's not like they've been doing that for 100 years at South Carolina. You know, I mean, Joe Morrison one day was like, I think we should come out to 2001. And then they came out to 2001, right. And now all of a sudden it's a tradition. So it really is neat.
For a time, I mean, when I was first really introduced to Gamecock athletics in the late 90s, everybody knows that the fan base is incredible. I mean, you look at that crowd for Kentucky, you wouldn't know that was a team with a losing record going into that game, right?
No.
I mean, so the reputation of the fan base has always been there. But at times I felt like there was an identity crisis. And part of that comes from you go from the ACC, then you're an independent, and then you're in the SEC. And it's like, who's your, other than Clemson, who's your rival? You know, there's been a lot of that. And Mike McGee, for all the good that he did, he didn't believe in the little things. Okay, he was very spendthrift and didn't, facilities were really lagging. I mean, I couldn't believe how far they were behind when I kind of just, you know, examined it and then compared it and contrasted. Well, that's history. There is an identity. The facilities are incredible. When I go to Columbia now and I look around and I think of how it's improved over the last decade, it's immense. It's absolutely immense. So all those little things, the packaging and the branding, those don't just happen on that. You have to have people that actually give a crap about it. And I think they've done all the right things there. And now I know how fans, well, yeah, but now we need more wins. I get it. Yeah, of course. That's the goal. That's what everybody's trying to do. And that's always been a challenge in 100 years. I think I read a stat where in 112 or however many years, South Carolina football has finished in the top 20 8 times. And of course, half of those were under Spurrier. It's really hard to do that here. It just is. It just is. But everybody in power is they're doing the right things to get to that point. I don't think they're skipping steps. I don't think they're taking shortcuts. I think they're trying to do all the right things in every sport to do it. It just ain't easy. Just ask all the other schools that are firing coaches and everything else and that's going on. This is a tough gig, folks, and it's going to be even tougher when Oklahoma and Texas come to town, but it doesn't mean you bury your head in the sand and say, woe is me. You just keep fighting the good fight, and that'll be another good fight on Saturday to try to beat a Clemson program 2 years in a row. And really, at that point, you think it's the trajectory of one versus the other.
Well, that's I brought that up yesterday. I was going to ask you about that. You know, if Carolina clips them this weekend, they get their second in a row, and you look around, I mean, you've got to – JC brought up a good point yesterday. You got to figure in the offseason for the Tigers there – they're going to probably need to make some changes based on how they construct their roster from a portal standpoint, an NIL standpoint, and all those type things. I know Graham Neff was speaking on some of that today, actually, the NIL side at least. But you know, for if you get the general feel, Mike, if Carolina takes care of business Saturday evening and they finish the year at 500, which will only be one win off of where Clemson is in a weaker ACC, and they beat them for the second year in a row, you get the feeling going into the offseason that I'm not saying that's exactly what's happening. Carolina's going here and the Tigers are going down. I know Carolina fans want that. I'm not saying that, but the outside looking in, there is a little bit of that perception that could be the case, and then ultimately what happens in the offseason would probably end up dictating much of that perception.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Go ahead, JC.
No, I wasn't going to say anything. I was agreeing. Go ahead.
No, I would just add that because, look, this is not a get out the shovels. Clemson football is about to take a dirt nap. That's not the case. Yeah. They still recruit well.
That.
Of course they do. And Clemson wants Carolina to be buried as well. Like that's the nature. That's why it's a rivalry.
I'm not going all the way down that road. I'm just saying that's what it could look like if you get them. That's
yeah. And the thing is, you know, like Florida State, I don't think is going anywhere. And I hate to see that happen to Jordan Travis. That was a gruesome injury, and it's basically going to railroad any chance they have of winning a national championship. And they would have been an underdog anyway, but. I hate to see that for the kid because he's not a portal kid, by the way. He's been there 5 years. He's busted his rear end. He's everything I've heard about him. I only had him once. I did the Cheez-It Bowl last year where they beat Oklahoma. And we spoke to him briefly. Couldn't have been a better kid. So I hate to see that happen just as a fan of humanity. But Florida State's not going anywhere. Coach Norvell has figured it out. It's one of those volcano programs where once they – figure it out and they got the right coach, they're going to be good for a while. So Clemson did its job. They surpassed FSU and they became the mighty beast of the ACC, which has been pretty weak. But now they actually have, there's a new alpha dog in town in Tallahassee. So that makes Clemson's road to even a 12-team playoff more difficult. Meanwhile, if you're Carolina, if you win this game, and correct me if I'm wrong, gentlemen, the in-state recruiting right now advantage Carolina, right? Now, Clemson has recruited nationally better over the years, but you've got a situation where you can really start to feel like that gap is closing. Not unlike when Steve, those first 5 years, you know, it was not pretty, and they were losing to Clemson more than they were winning, and then all of a sudden – it took a turn, and before you knew it, Carolina was in one spot, and Clemson was down below. And then eventually, you know, it's cyclical. Like, this could bounce back and forth 10 more times in our lifetime, right? The supremacy within the state of South Carolina. But it all starts with what you do in that final game of the year. And if you could somehow win two in a row, and if you could beat them with a team that clearly has some issues and deficiencies, as this Gamecock team does, man, I think that would obviously go a long way.
It would speak volumes, yeah.
Oh, boy. So, yeah, you got that right. You got that right big time.
I got to say one thing before we go to break. Look, Saturday night, all you guys, let's be clear what I said. I didn't say anything about Lenore Sellers. You guys are acting like I'm criticizing that guy. I just said it's completely stupid to sit here and talk about how Rattler's not going through his progressions. You know, and then you use that to boost Lenore's, which I think he would even say you're an idiot for saying. And by the way, Saturday night, 15 years college football recruiting talent evaluation. So I'll put my track record up against yours any day, especially if you don't know enough about quarterbacking to say something that moronic. But I just want to make it clear, I'm the biggest Lenore Sellers fan on earth. I agree with you guys. So don't come back here in 4 years when he's winning a Heisman and say, look, well, we were right and y'all were wrong. I just want to make that clear. I'm not saying anything about Sellers. I love the guy. But to sit there and take a shot at Spencer like that, to pull it out of your rectum like that is ridiculous. So just I want to let you guys know that.
I can double that because JC's been telling me about Lenore Sellers since before the season started and telling me, like, Mike, wait till you see this kid. You're going to love him. But to criticize, I can't imagine what you would criticize with Spencer Rattler right now. Has he made some mistakes? Yeah. He's taken some sacks he shouldn't. He's had some intentional grounding he shouldn't. But, man, oh, man, considering what he's had to deal with and the plays he's made, you couldn't ask for much better.
But he doesn't lock in on receivers.
No.
That's the dumbest thing.
Where did that even come from?
That came from our chat box, unfortunately. And here's another idiot calling me sensitive. I'm not being sensitive. I'm being truthful. I'm all about the truth. I can't stand lies. I can't stand misinformation. I can't stand lies. And that's exactly what that is if you say something like that about Rattler, because you just don't know what the hell you're looking at all. I'm sorry.
When people respond with sensitive, they don't like being called out, so they have to find a way to turn it back to you.
Spencer Rattler has not been perfect this year, but he's not staring. Nobody would ever.
Been pretty close.
You guys don't understand. If he was staring down his receivers, you wouldn't have guys open. He wouldn't make the throws he made. If he's staring them down, it's going the other way. And he did. I am mistaken. He did have a pick six against that one against Tennessee. Stunk. But that wasn't him staring anybody down. That was just a bad decision. So anyway,
About Spencer, it was like, and I was thinking about it yesterday because Patrick Mahomes makes a throw where, you know, I mean,
the boot, like Aikman and Buck just go nuts, right? Like, oh my goodness, like what an incredible throw. What, you know, it was like, this is, you know, only the elite quarterback can make this throw. I was like, I see that throw. I've seen that throw on Saturday come from a guy's arm at South Carolina. I mean, that's, you know, you can't say that he doesn't have the talent, you know, or that he's deficient in some way, shape, or form, when he literally does the exact same things that guys on Sunday in the announcer booths go nuts over.
Well,
yeah, and honestly, and that's not what I'm sorry, Mr. Knightley.
That's not what you said. Yeah. You didn't say it's good. He's leaving because you're
moving on is such a blessing. This is our GG Jackson moment,
which is the you throw that situation on there.
That's what
that's even dumber.
A GG Jackson of
the GG Jackson moment, right? we know things didn't really work out. Like Spencer's out there just playing selfish, like, and no. I mean,
that's remote drinking chicken cock on here, but not like two or three handles before 1 p.m. Like,
yeah. And what's the big difference this year in the offense and last year?
Oh, he's gonna bring up last year. Have you not again educate yourself to the clown show that was calling plays?
Yeah.
So come on, well, man.
Hey, tune into the points monster that's going to be Iowa, Nebraska this weekend.
You move the goalposts. That's how you
work. All right. Maybe we've given this a little too.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Too much oxygen. So, you know, go watch. Too much oxygen.
Nobody else is really saying this. So, why are we like, nobody, everybody else that has paid attention to this Spencer Rattler's career understands he has been nothing but exceptional considering what he has had to work with. And yeah, you are going to make some bad decisions when you got a line that doesn't block and your go-to receiver's been out all year long in Juice Wells and you don't have much of a running game. I mean, do I need to continue? That's when quarterbacks start getting into some bad habits. And even with all that, I think for the most part, he has avoided that. He has avoided bad habits. Amazing. And how many quarterbacks in today's day and age, and now I'm giving oxygen to it, but I'm out after this. You guys can continue to battle.
No, I'll be out too. No more.
How many quarterbacks in today's day and age?
I'm out.
Then I'm dropping the mic. How many quarterbacks in today's day and age that have, I mean, again, this was a five-star kid and the number one recruit and a Heisman Trophy candidate as a freshman at Oklahoma. That comes to South Carolina, he's got no O-line, he's got limited weapons, they're losing games, and what does he do? Does he sulk? Does he threaten to quit? Does he throw his teammates under the bus? No, he sits there and encourages guy. I promise you this, which is not what GG Jackson did, by the way, and I told you tape would be the worst enemy for GG, and that's why he went in the second round, he's playing in the G League. And I wish GG the best, he's going to be a pro, he's going to be fine, but that there's a difference between how GG handled it and a Spencer Rattler. It's night and frickin' day. Spencer Rattler has been the consummate pro and teammate during all of this, and he's the reason this team has a chance to go to a bowl game as opposed to be 2-10, which would have been possible if you had some of the other Hammond Eggers play the quarterback position this year for Carolina.
And here we go. So it's a football opinion. Nah, it's a dumb opinion. It's not football. That's not football what you're watching. I don't know what sport you think you're watching, but that's not. And don't use that. Don't look like you – like, oh, it's just my football opinion. Okay, good. Well, I'd love to I would love to coach against you, evaluate against you. I think you'd start crying and quit if you had to go against me with any of this stuff. So better be. I'm glad you just kind of do this as a hobby and it entertains you. And we do appreciate you listening. I just completely disagree.
You're cool. I'm out.
You're cool. I'm out.
He's for what it's worth. He's attempted 1,281 throws in his career. He has thrown 31. Interceptions. Locking in on receivers has not seemed to be an issue for Spencer Rattler.
No. And it won't be for Sellers either, from what I've seen. So you got a point.
Kids outstanding. Cannot wait to see him play. And by the way, we might probably get a chance to see him play this week. And if they, to your point earlier, JC, I would imagine that they issue another blanket waiver because there will be teams who don't have enough players to play in bowl games. So
I hope so.
Another waiver, then you'll have to allow red shirts to be able to play in the game. Mike, we were talking about that earlier. We've got 1 minute till we hit a timeout here, but that last year was that one season blanket waiver, you know, to allow red shirts to be able to play without losing it, or allow kids to play without losing a red shirt. More than likely with the transfer portal where it is, you're playing bowl games in the middle of the transfer portal. So, I mean, you know, they're probably going to have to look at this and adjust that rule and say you can play in the bowl game because some kids, I mean, there's going to be some teams who don't even have enough players, like the Gamecocks almost didn't last year, to go play.
They have a major issue that they have to address, and that is the schedule, the calendar. Yeah. If they want people to take these bowl games seriously, they're going to have to clean this up and stop being scared of a lawsuit and stop being scared of being accused of being this or that and the other. They have to do just one thing that's actually coach and program friendly and not just player friendly. Just one. You're getting paid. You got essentially, you got free agency. You got all these things right now that are 100% pro player. You got guys making seven figures, six figures all across the board. And even if the kid quits, they're still getting paid. Even if the kid sulks, they're still getting, like, none of that applies to pro players. Pro players, the NFL will cut your ass if you don't do what you're supposed to do, and you won't get a paycheck on the way out. Okay, there's very little guaranteed money in the NFL. So you've got to do one thing that actually makes sense here, and that is change the calendar and actually give more incentive for kids to hang on to the commitment that they made and participate in bowl games. They have to do that if they want any of this to be taken seriously.
I agree. I would add, too, one of the dumbest things out there is that you can't have a bowl cut an NIL deal with a kid. They call it pay to play. That's what these bowls are. That's what people sponsor. They're big NIL deals, basically, for the whole team.
Totally.
And so I don't.
So instead of giving them a big swag bag with a PlayStation, Xbox, and, you know, iPods, and how about you just cut them a check? But you got to play to get it.
You know. So and Kendall, I didn't call anybody any names. I don't remember name calling at all. I've called the opinion stupid, which it is.
Yeah.
And respect is earned.
Yeah, you can give any opinion you want.
So quit. I mean, yeah, come on, man. I mean, I know you want to. I know you guys both are a little butthurt because you think that we were against Lenoris, and you know you're right about that. I said, but I mean, you haven't listened to me talk very much. If you think I don't think Lenoris Sellers is special, I just don't. I just that evaluation of Spencer Rattler blew my mind. So I'm sorry if I blew up about it, but that's just me. And my audience and my fans, if I didn't do that for all, they literally write me a letter and say, are you okay?
By the way, can I just add, JC, you sounded better in that blow-up because your microphone is perfectly stationed. They got eye contact when the rage was coming out. This all actually worked in a very technically efficient way.
I've got another box on top of my Manscaped box, so I feel like I'm getting somewhere now.
Here we go. I love it.
Speaking of opinions, is it stuffing or dressing? Don't answer. This is always a big. This is a big
hard deal. Hitting.
See, my fiance has a different opinion than me, so I got to be quiet.
This is our show, and it's not hers, so she can go away.
Wow!
Remember, her opinion doesn't matter again. We'll be right back.
Down here in the South, we don't always see eye to eye. While our taste in college football teams, or what sauce, if any, goes best on a rack of ribs, or what to mix with our Dixie vodka might be up for debate, we can all agree there's nothing better than a Southern tailgate. And like our favorite college teams, our ingredients come from small towns and big cities. They're grown in Southern soil, are crafted by Southern hands, and proudly represent the South in our backyard and beyond. So raise a glass of Dixie Southern Vodka to celebrate being made in America and raised in the South.
Electric Bikes of Charleston offers the most fun you'll ever have on two wheels. Magnum, Velotric, Aventon Bikes, and more. And they sell to consumers all across the state and offer outstanding warranties and service after the sale. Five levels of pedal assist plus a throttle help you handle the southern heat better, but still get great exercise. Bikes are available all ages and sizes. ElectricBikesCharleston.com or stop into their store in Mount Pleasant. Electric Bikes of Charleston, powering inside the Gamecocks, the show. Golfers and wannabe golfers, former Gamecock golfer Meredith Taylor is now a full-time golf instructor in the Midlands of South Carolina. In-person golf lessons are held at the Country Club of Lexington. Half hour, hour, on course 9 or 18 holes. And if you're outside of South Carolina, Meredith conducts virtual lessons. Just send in your golf swing for analysis. Gift cards are available for in-person one-hour lessons. Connect on Twitter at Mayor Taylor and find her online at McKellarEnterprises.org. Her email is on the website. Schedule your next lesson today with Meredith Taylor, former Gamecock golfer.
Not today, sweetie.
One heart's breaking while another one is mending. It's all in the ebb and flow. If I had to, I could go it alone. But because you've become my home. These windows could shut into the ground. These walls could fall right down.
You don't have to tell Mom, right?
Because you've become my home.
With a little love and some tenderness, we'll walk upon the water, we'll rise above the mist. With a little peace and some harmony, we'll take the world together, we'll take them by the hand. Cause I got a hand for you. Oh, I wanna run with you. Yesterday I saw you standing there.
All right, it's a shade after 1 o'clock here on Tuesday, a rainy Tuesday afternoon, unfortunately. November the 21st, we're just a couple of days shy of one of the great days of the year, Thanksgiving. Happy Thanksgiving week to all of you who are watching and listening to our program and to all of your families, wherever you're traveling this holiday season. Please be safe in doing so. Mike Morgan here for the final hour. Mike will also be back tomorrow. We'll be off on Thursday and then be back Friday as we get you ready to rock and roll for Clemson and Carolina. Tonight, the college football playoff rankings will be coming out as well. We're going to get heavy into that here in just a few moments. All right.
I'm sorry. I was laughing about something. I remember when Muschamp called Thanksgiving a meal and not a holiday.
Yes, I do. That was a moment.
That poor guy, man, he couldn't win for losing. He goes and says something like that. Of course, they go and ask Dabo, the Clemson media. They run right to Dabo. Dabo, what do you? Oh, it's a holiday. We spend time with our families. And Muschamp's just going, oh man, I stepped in at this time. And they asked Beamer that when he first got here. Beamer's like, oh, it's a holiday. And poor Muschamp. I was just, what? What are you thinking, dude?
Well, on that holiday, one of the great side items is stuffing or dressing based on where you're from. Today is National Stuffing Day, for what that's worth. Now, my understanding, and Mike, we'll start with you. You're the guest of honor, the Golden Tones. If it's stuffed, it's stuffing. If it's made outside of the bird, it's dressing. Is that how would you
I'll go along with that. Okay. I'm not a big stuffing guy.
Oh,
no, not a big
favorite side item.
Typically, like, I try to go healthy on the side because I know I'm going to stuff my face and load up on desserts. I'll go like green beans,
Southern style.
And if you can put some bacon bits in there, you know, really kind of spruce
bacon
it up.
Bacon grease would do.
And I'll tell you this: my only thing on Thanksgiving, and this is a little shout out to Chris Bacchus and his family. I know they're also fans of the show back in Columbia. I remember one of my first years there, obviously I had no family there, and I had to, you know, to work like what we do now. I did a talk show every day, and then I had to be part of the coverage of the football game, and so I wasn't going anywhere. So I was kind of by myself. And they invited me to their house for Thanksgiving with the family. And it's the first time I ever had fried turkey. They put it in the deep fryer. Chris was like a great cook. And I was like, oh, that's interesting. I'll give it a shot. And from that day on, he spoiled me. If I could have fried turkey every year, that's the way it would be. I frown upon not having it fried. But I know I'm probably in the minority there. But once you've had a deep fried turkey, it's hard to go back.
As long as it's done right.
Well, I'm kind of turkey agnostic. I'm not a big turkey fan. I mean, I'll eat it at Thanksgiving and, you know, the subsequent leftover sandwiches. But
okay,
I'm not a huge fan of it. But I like it either way.
Okay. All right. I've got one more question for both of you here. But Phil, stuffing or dressing? Is it stuffing or dressing? Or did you agree with my diplomatic?
The delineation is, you know, whether it's in the bird or out of the bird, you know, yep, how it's prepared. But I'm a dressing guy all the way. I don't want the, okay, I don't want the soggy, you know.
All right.
Bacterial soup that could potentially be coming out of that bird.
JC, are you, so you've got the dilemma of all dilemmas because you're living up there in Yankee land.
They call it stuffing.
Yeah, but you're from, so what do you do? And you've got the whole pie thing going on here.
Yeah, I don't know what they call it. I did learn how to say go Cocks or go Gamecocks in Thai. It's
okay.
I'll think about it in a second.
Just say it.
It's
don't think about it. Just
I'll think about it.
It's like, yo, it's Chayo. Chayo means go. Like, Chayo means go. At the end of the Thai national anthem, they all like raise their hands and go, Chayo. So it's Chayo Lumpa. Go Roosters. Go Roosters. Or go Chickens.
We're going by
Chayo Lumpa.
Yeah.
Chayo Lumpa. Chayo Lumpa.
Golly, if you went to Thailand and started yelling that, you might get some interesting responses back.
I think there's a pretty active cockfighting ring in Thailand. I think it's legal there. So maybe they're like, come here, I want to give you this Lumpa. Wow, you went the little Jerry Seinfeld, right? but you know, no, I don't know what they call it. I just know her parents love it. I mean, we did Thanksgiving 2 years ago. We did Christmas 2 years ago. Last year I was sick during Christmas, and I think they were out of town Thanksgiving. But we got a honey baked ham and took it over there. They're like, I make this stuff called Russian salad. It's like a gelatin with pecans and a lot of stuff that's terrible for you. There's mayonnaise involved. I mean, it's Jell-O. It's good, though. It was from my dad's side of the family. My aunt used to bring it. My dad called it that green stuff. He didn't say stuff, but they loved it. Everybody loved the green stuff. And so I made that. We made southern green beans. We made mashed potato. We made mac and cheese. I mean, it was off the chain. But I call it, to answer the question, I call it dressing, just because that's in it. And in our family, we had, you know, the big casserole dish with the dressing, you know, and all that good stuff.
All right, here's the next one. This is another very debatable Thanksgiving practice. Are y'all plate mixers? Do you mix it all in there and just eat it, or are
heck
you
no?
You section it off.
Oh, you got to section it off. Yeah, cool. I don't like one food group touching the other.
Really?
Yeah. For me, it's like we're back in COVID times, and you keep your social distancing between the turkey and the green beans.
Socially distance your Thanksgiving.
I social distance my servings on my Thanksgiving plate. I double mask. Absolutely.
No. Oh gosh, I pile it on, man.
By the way,
I just keep piling it.
Just a quick aside, you would be amazed at how many people are still double masking outside in California, but that's a whole other story altogether.
No, we wouldn't.
It's a whole other story altogether.
No, we wouldn't.
I'm not surprised.
Are we still on the Thanksgiving
Yeah, I got to – I am a – all right, I do – all right. With on that note, the mixing it all together. Like, I would throw up if I just, like, took everything and piled it on top and ate it like a barbecue platter or something. Like, you know, you do that when they throw the fries on top of it or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
I can't do it like that. What I will say is I just do my best.
All right.
So if it gets mixed, it gets mixed, but I try to separate all of it.
I have certain thing like stuffing or dressing, either however you want to call it. That mashed potatoes, turkey, I'll put all that on one fork and let's do it.
Yeah, mashed potatoes mixes with and stuffing. Yeah, I mean that's different because the anything gravy goes on. Like if you're putting gravy on everything, you could mix that.
Yeah, that's exactly.
But I'm not putting gravy on my broccoli casserole, which is that's another side I love.
My mom makes killer broccoli casserole. Hers is more like souffle. It's not as broccoli-y. Broccoli-y? Is that a term? Broccoli-y?
Yeah, sure. That works. It is now.
It is.
Jesus. Listen, right. Communication is all about whether or not the audience can understand. We know exactly what you're saying.
But I will do like ham and mac and cheese. I'll mix that because I think that's a good mixture.
You're selective. I get it. But I'll, just, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't mind. Like, if it all. So, did any of you, Mike, you probably, I know people in this chat box have Sweatman's Barbecue in Utahville, South Carolina. All right, back in the day, when you went through the line, they would give you one plate, okay? And you could only go through once, all right? And so, and when I first started going there, it was almost $5 a plate. Now it's like $17 a plate. But so this is where all this really kind of truly started for me. You had to learn how to place it all on the plate to get as much as you could for the $5 you were spending. Barbecue, ribs, rice and hash, mac and cheese, you know, all that stuff, green beans, whatever you're going to put on there. And so you would get it to where it was, you know, some was going to be mixing, but like you had to build a mountain. I mean, you only got one plate and it was a styrofoam plate. And it, you know, if you put it in the wrong area, the thing's going to break. So you had to be really, so now when I make my Thanksgiving plates, I've been doing this for 30 years. Like I'm just used to like, okay, how can I build this mountain to where it all perfectly touches? These are going to mix. These are going to mix. It's really strategical when I'm making my Thanksgiving plate. Doesn't that sound a little weird and bizarre, but it is what it is.
No,
like, I don't come back for seconds. I just fill that plate up.
This is what makes you, you, Jamie. This is why you're good at what you do. You're very meticulous. You're a perfectionist. I've been accused of being the same. And that carries over into other facets of life. There's nothing
Jesus,
wrong
man,
with that.
Just put the freaking green beans on your plate. No, that's where the ham goes.
No, we social distance. I'm sorry. We there's, yeah. I
so
don't
how
like,
many do you go through? Do you have a big meal where you have, like, we'll have 7 or 8 sides and turkey and ham. Do you have all that? Do you put it all on there? Do you just do half and then come back for the next half?
I come back. I'm not afraid to get up and go second, third plate club, which sounds more gluttonous than it actually is because, again, I don't stack it up high and just mix a bunch of stuff together and make a mountain of gumbo, if you will, Thanksgiving gumbo. And I only eat turkey once a year. I'm with JC. Like if you replaced this fine tradition that we have, that is Thanksgiving, from the turkey to say barbecue, I would be all in because I'd much rather have barbecue, to be honest with you. I eat turkey once a year. I don't love it. I like it. And if it's fried, I might love it. I stack up on turkey, couple of sides, come back, a little more turkey, couple more sides, and then it's dessert time. That's how I roll.
What's your go-to dessert?
Anything but pumpkin pie. Oh. I'm not a pumpkin pie guy. You could think of 100 things I'd rather eat for dessert than pumpkin pie.
Pumpkin pie, I used to not touch it. It's grown on me, though. The kids like it. It's like, I got it. And it's like all I can think about, there's a pumpkin pie in there.
So my wife, her signature item, and it really is signature. I mean, she could sell these and we'd be a lot richer than everything else we do. She makes a pumpkin pie cheesecake that is
okay.
You had me a cheesecake.
It's
heavily requested every year. We're not allowed to show up unless she has it. we're hosting this year, so naturally we'll, there's nothing they could do about it, but we're going to graciously make one anyways. It is the best dessert I've ever had. I mean, it's
a banana pudding. Can't go wrong with banana pudding.
No, that's more of an Easter thing.
The pumpkin pie's got to have all Cool Whip.
So is potato salad and deviled eggs, but they also will eat them at Thanksgiving. Deviled eggs, potato salad, and
mayo.
I would go down with deviled eggs. If you gave me like, there's only one food you can eat, that would be one of the ones I'd have to choose between.
I got in trouble after the Mississippi State game, the Kimry Pass game in 2000.
Wait a second.
Swung by this tailgate.
Where's this going with deviled eggs?
Now? No, we swung by this tailgate, and the lady was like, would you like a deviled egg or two? And I was like, sure. And I ate about four, and she literally snatched the Tupperware up and covered it up and threw it in the car. I'm like,
what's that do to your gut the rest of the day is my question.
Oh, I'm used to it. I'm good. It doesn't give me
wind. That'd really be social distancing from you if you loaded up on deviled eggs.
Deviled eggs don't give me wind. Like maybe you'd think the wind, sauerkraut and anything with cabbage. Yeah, that's disgusting. But
I had a buddy of mine, Pat, who whenever he had eggs, we knew like, Pat, we're keeping distance, brother, because you can't, your stomach can't handle them, and you're clearing out the room for crying out loud. He ate them religiously, and he had them for lunch one day, and we went to a digital underground concert. That's right, Humpty Hump.
All right, dance. Stop what you're doing because I'm about to ruin
The image and the style that you're used to. I look funny. Yeah, I'm making money. See, so your world, I hope you're ready for me. Now gather around. Anyway, we go to that, and everybody's like dancing on the dance floor as Humpty's doing his thing. And by the way, while we're giving out RIPs, the actual guy who played Humpty just passed away. And I just, somebody in chat row, you'll have the name for me. I know it. He was actually really talented, really, really talented. Anyway, so we're out there, and my friend Pat, who had eggs, he is letting them rip, and everybody on the dance floor is looking like a bomb went off. They're clearing their nose. They're getting out. I'm like, Pat, you just cleared out an entire digital underground concert. I hope you're proud of yourself. I was just waiting for it to reach the band, and they were going to have to leave the stage. So we all have a friend like that that at times gets a little bit too gassy, and hopefully that won't happen over Thanksgiving. That's the moral.
Yeah, I just couldn't believe that selfish lady taking those deviled eggs. I was a poor college student at the time. I maybe had $25 to my name. I was starving, you know, because, no alcohol at the game during those times. So you get out and get that kind of hangover hunger after a ball game. Mm-hmm. And she looked. They parked under. That was back when you could park under the stadium. They parked under the stadium, so you know they could afford it. How much was that? Were deviled eggs in 2000? 3 cents a piece to make, maybe.
Maybe.
I want to keep it for herself. Come on, man.
As we continue this ADD segment, yes, I'm well aware Tupac was with Shock G. This was before Tupac was Tupac. He was part of a Digital Underground, of course. In recent news, we all know Tupac was murdered by Phil, the Mad Dog. They finally cracked the case. So, Phil, congratulations on getting your lawyer to allow you to stay on this show until you get locked up. But
Statute of limitations.
Yeah, statute of limitations.
According to the...
Gave Phil a dirty look. That was all she wrote.
According to recent conference realignment news, the Tupac is alive and well down in Washington State and Oregon State.
Yeah, yeah.
Today's version of Tupac. Just so everybody knows, I love banana pudding. Again, another signature meal of my wife's. But we hold it and do it for Easter, and we do pumpkin pie cheesecake for this time of year.
There we go.
It's okay. Yeah. It's just how we do it. Like it's just how we do it.
I don't think banana pudding's been on Thanksgiving for me for a little while, because my mom does. We were talking about this on Gunner's show today on 107.5. He always has like a little off-topic plan. And so it was like bench one dessert, second team for one dessert, and what's your starter? And my mom's apple pie, unbelievable. I mean, it's the best apple pie I've ever had in my life.
Is it?
And
like
it's not just because my mom makes it.
Like American pie apple pie or like other
version? Well, it's not that good, Jamie. No pie in the traditional sense has made me that excited.
That apple pie is undefeated.
There's some other types of pies that I will get around for.
There's as many coaches who have been fired over that apple pie.
Yeah.
I think that apple pie. Bobby Petrino says hello.
Yeah. Bobby on line two, hold my beer.
Yeah. Hey. Hugh Freeze, line three.
Hugh Freeze, line three, hold my beer.
Something worse than that happened to Hugh Freeze this past weekend, though. I mean, I'm like,
oh, my goodness.
That's like the trifecta for him. Like, all right. So he got in trouble for escorts. Then he had to coach from a hospital bed at Liberty. And now he got beat by three touchdowns by Jerry Kill at home.
Yeah.
So I don't think anything else bad is going to happen to Hugh Freeze. That's like three of the worst possible things as a coach that you could have happen.
There's a whole article, I read it somewhere on the plane ride back, about how things went down at Ole Miss and how Houston Nutt, you know, he kind of helped that whole investigation get started, and then Hugh Freeze. And I mean, honestly, if there wasn't the NCAA, I think Hugh Freeze would have kept that job. Ole Miss fans loved Hugh Freeze. And this just in, he ain't the first head football coach to have some extramarital stuff going on. So the fan bases overlook that stuff when you're beating Alabama 2 years in a row. But it was obvious they were about to go on probation. It's funny, I did a lot of those games when Matt Luke took over, and there were still so many talented players left over from Hugh's recruiting. I mean, guys like Metcalf and, you know, I mean, all these first-round draft pick wide receivers, they called them the New World Order, and they'd catch a touchdown and put the belt on and all that shtick. Hugh Freeze had it rolling at Ole Miss, and I think he will get it rolling at Auburn, but that loss, that one's almost unexplainable. And, yeah, I heard you guys mention, you know, Las Cruces yesterday. That might be the most difficult job in the history of D1 football, having been there to do a game. They played Nevada when Kaepernick was there on my first ESPN games, and I was like, is this really the stadium? Is this it's unreal how Jerry Kill gets any players to go there. So kudos to him and the Aggies on that victory, because that is a tough, tough job.
Like I said, he's a Greek tragedy of a coach, man. If it weren't for his health problems, and bless his heart, I mean, he is overcome. He is an overcomer, and he took that job. I think if he would have gone on from Minnesota, Mike, and would have probably been at a Michigan, Notre Dame, Ohio, someplace winning championships. He's that good of a coach.
You've been on him for years. You've been
the kill zone
praises for a while.
The kill zone.
I'm going to trademark that tomorrow. And the 1,100 New Mexico State fans that show up, you can buy the T-shirts on the Chief Sports app.
And in fairness to the athletic program there, they are a good basketball school. They're always a consistent NCAA tournament team. So
always have been.
They're good at basketball, but boy,
it's a good job. It's a good basketball job. It is a very difficult football job. While we're doing ADD radio here, a long time ago, somebody mentioned Trey Kelly schooling Devin Downey. Yeah, that was in the NIT at Cincinnati when Downey was with the Bearcats and everybody was hyping up Devin. Trey Kelly and the Gamecocks rolled up in there, and he schooled Devin Downey. Trey Kelly will go down as one of the most underrated Gamecock basketball players of all time, for my money. Doesn't get the respect he deserves. He was terrific. And just came this close, a hair close of making an NBA roster. I've kept in touch with Trey, and that dude was on basically a torn ACL, was still out there playing, hard. Didn't have to do it, but he did. He was a coach's dream. So yeah, Trey Kelly deserves a better place in Gamecock history and folklore, because he did a lot of good things for that program and won a lot of big games. Just saying. And Hane Painter. And the only reason I'm getting right to Hane is because he's a Fab Five champion. And we all know those are a different level of listener when you're a Fab Five champion. Any other sports besides football, basketball, baseball that I've called? Track and field. My first couple of years at Fox with Carl Lewis's sister, Carol Lewis.
Oh.
Called the Big 12 Championships in track and field for, I think, 3 years. And I had a lot to study up and learn. It was one of the most difficult things I ever did. It's an 8-hour day behind the microphone, but I actually learned to love it. I really did. Anyway, that's all. That's all. I'm done. Back to Carolina Clemson.
Nice little.
So technically, one day, Mike, you could be an Olympic. Call it Bob Costas. And getting to put you in the rotation.
I would be glad to do it. I'll take that NBC paycheck, but I don't think I'll be on their short list of people. Football, basketball, baseball is my comfort zone. Like, I love that. Yeah. So when they asked, I actually talked to my agent. I said, do you think I should do this? I could embarrass myself. He's like, Mike, you got to do it. You'll be fine. Just study up. And I mean, I prepared for that like I've never prepared for anything in my life, because I didn't want to be that person that says the wrong thing, the wrong nomenclature. It'd be like if I was doing if you heard an announcer doing a football game, and instead of like saying, well, he ran the ball and he just used the wrong terminology.
Advanced the ball. Yeah. Goal. And the Gamecocks are going and wanting to score a goal here.
Yeah.
Way to go.
Should they play for four and go for the field goal, or go for the touchdown? What do you think, Bill?
It's only three
for the field goal, Mike.
It's like me and hockey. Hockey came back before anything during the pandemic, and I was up here. Blackhawks were in the playoffs, and so everybody loves the Blackhawks. It's like hockey's big in Chicago. So I'm all fired up, you know. I got my Blackhawks jersey on. Yes, I have one. I'm at the bar, and I'm like, what time's first ice, fellas?
What time's first ice?
Nice.
You ain't from around here, boy.
Complete idiot, you know. First ice, yeah, you know.
Oh, goodness. Yeah, yeah. So that's a bad thing. That's a very bad. You had some guy call Sean Beamer for 3.5 hours, so that's not good either.
I took note of that, Mike, and I think he was on the next week's broadcast too, and he's probably the worst one out of all
wasn't
of them.
Wasn't he the same guy that called the Oregon State Beavers the Ducks for 3 hours?
Yep, same guy.
I don't know. I'm staying out of it, but morning.
I was alerted to that.
Yeah. Anyway, we about time for a break.
We got to step aside for a timeout. Yes, that is absolutely correct. We're part of the Chief Sports Network, which of course is served by Chicken Cock Whiskey and Dixie Vodka. If you haven't tried it and you're planning on having Bloody Marys around for your family, or at least to get yourself through your family this holiday, make sure you get the Dixie Pepper Vodka wherever you buy your vodka. Dixie Pepper Vodka. We are so honored to be partnered with them throughout the year here on Inside the Gamecocks, the show. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
Chicken cock originated in Kentucky, like so many other bourbons. And so the resurrection of it, you know, Paris, Kentucky, that's the county seat of Bourbon County. So much of this whiskey was being made in that Bourbon County, put on ships and barges and shipped down Ohio, down the Mississippi, and got to New Orleans, where it got distributed all over the world. And people kept saying, well, hey, I want some more of that whiskey from Bourbon County. And so that's how bourbon whiskey got its name. And Chicken Cock originated actually in Paris, Kentucky, which is today Bourbon County.
If you're in the upstate of South Carolina and are in need of residential real estate services, Cindy Bass Searfoss of Caldwell Banker Kane is for you. Ask her about the Village at Creekside, all of her listings in my hometown of Spartanburg, South Carolina, right there on Daniel Morgan Avenue, married to a lifelong Gamecock fan. And many of our listeners have already bought homes from her and been 100% satisfied with the detail and care she uses. Cindy Searfoss, 864-414-5271, Caldwell Banker Kane in the upstate for your real estate needs.
Building your dream home is often just that, a dream. And sometimes a nightmare. But at the Barn Dough Company, they commit to quality and build without sacrifice. Customization, open floor plans, limitless flooring options, maintenance-free and easy insulation perks, and affordability are just a few reasons why they've been named one of the best builders in the U.S. Believe in your dreams. Visit thebarndominiumco.com. That's thebarndominiumco.com. The Barn Dough Company. Gamecock-owned. Gamecock-operated. The preferred sign partner of Gamecock Athletics is Signorama Columbia, and they should be yours too. A full-service sign company that handles design, production, install, and service, Signorama Columbia has helped to bring to life the perfect vision for so many all across South Carolina. Owned and operated by proud Gamecock alumni, they can handle all types of signage, including interior and exterior, vehicle graphics, and more. Go to signorama.com and find the West Columbia location, or call them at 803-407-9284. Bring your brand to life with Signorama
Mama Columbia, and go Gamecocks.
This is Jacoby Wright from Gamecock Basketball, and you are listening to the show with JB, Bill, and JC. Go Gamecocks.
Oh, welcome back. 131 here on Inside the Gamecocks, the show built by the Barn Dough Co. and always, of course, live from the Cinerama Studios. Want to, golly, I cannot, for whatever reason, I'm losing my voice. Want to remind all of you, we are almost to Black Friday, and that means we're really into shopping mode. If you have not begun that shopping, Gamecock Traditions has got you taken care of. It's going to be 49 degrees as of now at kickoff on Saturday evening as well. If you're going to be in town early, make sure you slide on over to Gamecock Traditions in Lexington and get yourself dressed up so you'll be warm throughout, hopefully, a winning evening for Carolina, which would be, of course, their second win in a row over the Tigers, just like now they have over the Kentucky Wildcats after what happened last weekend. Gamecock Traditions, they'll take care of you this holiday season. Anything and everything you need, if it's got the logo, they've got it. GamecockTraditions.com. A reminder, they'll ship it right to your door.
And while we're talking about our great sponsors, of course, the Power Hour presented by Brian Spencer of Palmetto Medicare, palmetto-medicare.com. Again, it's the enrollment period. You folks have been bombarded by all the national commercials for that. Martha and other cranky old bags telling you that they should go ahead and call an 800 number. If you're in the state of South Carolina, you probably want a South Carolina person helping you. The guy to do that has been Brian Spencer since 2005. He'll help you through the process, whether you like it or not, just like so many other things going on in the economy. You know, we don't ask for higher gas prices or higher price of food or simple common things that used to be a decent price a few years ago. That just happens. Well, sometimes they just change your Medicare coverage too. So if you're thinking about you or a loved one, you might want to make sure that you're getting the right plan for you. One phone call can save you a lot of money. 803-960-9484, 803-960-9484, Brian Spencer of Palmetto Medicare. And also my man Gary Patterson of GaryPatterson.net, State Farm agent Gary Patterson for all of you in the Midlands. He's been my guy for over 20 years. He worked the Virginia Tech game last week. I'm trying to find out which game he's working this week. It will not be Carolina Clemson. They typically don't allow people with ties to the state or any school to do that. But he'll be working some big game this weekend. So you can complain about all the calls that you didn't like, and you can get yourself some great insurance rates from Gary Patterson with one simple phone call. And again, you can find out all his contact information on GaryPatterson.net.
Mike, the college football playoff will release their rankings tonight. It is a these will be important. You've already mentioned one thing, and that was that Jordan Travis is out for the year for Florida State. Now, last week Florida State was fourth. Were they fourth last week? Yeah, they were fourth in the college football playoff rankings. What is interesting, or what in your mind will be important about these rankings that come out this evening?
Well, there's a big debate now on how you're going to handle Florida State. Are you going to judge them based on their resume, or are you going to judge them based on the fact they're not going to have Jordan Travis the rest of the year? Now, this might all take care of itself if Florida, who's also playing with a backup quarterback, this is the backup quarterback bowl in the swamp. It's almost surreal to be saying that, but you had two quarterbacks that have actually played quite well for each school. Obviously, Florida State's a better team with more success, but I don't know anything about Florida State's backup. I can tell you he's not Jordan Travis. And if they do beat Florida, and now they're 12-0, and they somehow pull off a win against Louisville in the ACC championship game, and they're 13-0, all this does become relevant. Like, for weeks I've been saying these polls don't matter. Right now it starts becoming relevant and where it does matter. So what are you going to do with Oregon and Florida State? Because that to me is going to be pretty fascinating. Oregon still has Washington, of course. I was looking at Jerry Palm's list, and we'll go over this tomorrow on the Love Chevy Drive Around the SEC. He believes Oregon's going to win the rematch. So he's got Georgia 1, Michigan 2, Florida State 3, and Oregon 4. By the way, he does have 9 SEC schools in the bowl parade, and he does not have South Carolina or Florida. So obviously he's predicting they're both going to lose this weekend. But yeah, I think, Jamie, to answer your question, now all of a sudden these things are quite entertaining. Now, 1-3 always works out, right? I mean, Georgia's going to roll up Georgia Tech unless they just completely catnap through the game. And Michigan, if they beat Ohio State, you know, they're gonna roll in the Big Ten championship game, or Ohio State's going to roll in the Big Ten championship game. So somebody from the Big Ten's going to be in the playoff. Somebody from the SEC is going to be in the playoff. But then it becomes a battle of a number of different teams for 3, 4, 5, and that's where things really get entertaining. So what happens on rivalry weekend, it's either going to make it convenient for the committee, or it could cause the most chaos that we've had in the 4-team playoff era.
Is there anything that happened last weekend? I mean, aside from the injury to Jordan Travis, is there anything that happened last weekend that could shift any of what we saw the top 7 or 8 to be last week? Like, do you feel like all that will just kind of maintain status quo?
Well, like I said, if Florida State loses to Florida, they're beyond done.
No, I mean in the rankings tonight, like when the rankings are unveiled tonight.
Oh. So Georgia's going to stay at 1, obviously.
Michigan will not pass them.
Michigan will not pass them.
Would you flip-flop Ohio State and Michigan since Michigan struggled against Maryland? I don't know.
And again, that'll take care of itself on Saturday in the Big House, right? So whether or not Michigan flip-flops Ohio State with Ohio State or not, I'm not sure it really matters a whole lot because the loser of that game is – I think they're going to be behind the – I don't think they're two are getting in from the Big Ten. It's going to be one of those two, and that's it. Now, if you really want chaos, have Alabama beat Georgia in Atlanta. Now we're really cooking. Now we're cooking. But in terms of the poll tonight, Jamie, I don't mean to evade your question. I'm not looking for a whole lot of surprises based on what happened this past weekend.
Yeah, I don't think that there's anything that happened this past weekend that would really change what those will look like this evening. I mean, it's really all going to come down to this coming weekend. I think we have, of all the championship games, I think there's only 4 across all leagues that are already set. So a lot of that's actually going to be, you know, able to unfold Friday and Saturday. You got Oregon State playing in the Civil War and things like that. I do, though, like, so Ohio State and Michigan, so Michigan struggled to beat Maryland last week, 31-24. Was that the final, 31-24?
Yeah, it was a Maryland kid dropped almost like a, I don't know if it would have been a pick six or not. I think it was Jayshon Barham who the Gamecocks recruited. I think he's 49, but that could have really made it much more interesting, but you know, Michigan got up big, and then they let Maryland come back on. That was what they kind of lost focus a little bit.
Yeah, I mean, like, let's say that game this weekend. Y'all anticipate that game to be close, Michigan and Ohio State? I do.
I think it's going to be absolutely. I think it's going to be. First of all, that not to bore you with TV talk, but that is going to draw an insane number. The really, really good games in college football generally are 4 million and above. The Deion hype train early on was getting ridiculous numbers, and now nobody cares about Colorado anymore, and they've kind of they're irrelevant. But a game like that will have over, you mark my words, will have over 10 million viewers. 4 is a great number. 4. That'll have over 10. It's going to be, because the Harbaugh drama pulls in people that ordinarily would care less about Michigan, Ohio State, but all of a sudden now you've got a little extra intrigue and drama, and drama is great for TV, so that will draw an insane number.
Okay, yeah, go ahead, JC.
No, it's like it's already one of the most high-profile rivalries in the country. I mean, it already draws a good number every year, but that game's at noon, right? I mean, so
yep.
You don't have a lot of competition in the time slot. It's, yeah, I'm with you there, bud.
Well, you've got another scenario here, though, Mike. We hit on this last week where let's say it's 31-30, something like that, something crazy, 31-30. And I don't know, pick your loser. Where's this game being played? In the Big House?
Yeah.
So, all right. So Ohio State falls 31-30 at Michigan, and they're ranked number two. Again, you've got another, like, are they really not one of the four best teams in the country? I know that they got beat by Michigan, but – you know, who's going to – we'll have to see what the rest of it looks like. I mean, Washington, you know, if they win out, if Florida State wins out, but they're without Jordan Travis, would a Florida State team without Jordan Travis be better than a one-loss Ohio State team who lost by 1 point on the road in Michigan? I mean, you've got another scenario here where, like, if you're the second-ranked team and you lose by a point or two in this thing, it's a heartbreak-type game that you're going to have an argument. Now, I'm not saying you're going to win the argument, but I'm saying you're going to have an argument when all this stuff comes down to it here in the next couple of weeks after you get through all these championship games.
And by the way, Jerry Palm is one of those people projecting Washington's finally going to leapfrog Florida State, not just because of the injury, but because of the schedule. You know, Washington has 4 wins over ranked opponents. Florida State does not.
Yeah.
And so that's like, to me, that's the only drama in the poll tonight specifically.
Okay, Florida State's best win is still LSU, right?
Yeah, which looks less and less because mm-hmm. LSU has not been who people like me thought they would be.
Right, right. So, you know, if you've got even Oregon with one loss, if they get in and beat Washington in the Pac-12 championship game and Florida State is undefeated, Oregon's sitting here going, well, we've got a bet. We have a loss, but you know, we didn't play that cupcake schedule year long either. We Pac-12 this year. Where's the Pac-12 ranked in y'all's minds amongst all of the Power Five?
Is it second or third?
Two?
Second or third by the SEC? Yeah.
Is it
ahead? And it's more like they don't have a Georgia and Bama at the top. They have Oregon and Washington, which they're good. But probably not at the level of those guys. They don't have an Ohio State, Michigan at the top, but the middle on down to Stanford and Colorado. Colorado's the last place team in the league now. But they're all good. I mean, like schools like teams like Arizona and Washington State and Cal, they've been competitive this year. So
yeah, that's the strength of that league. It's depth. In baseball, we use a term for a deep lineup. Correct. It's long. Right, mm-hmm. The Pac-12 is long. The Big Ten is not long at all. It's two really good teams, one good team, and then you can call Iowa good if you want.
and then Iowa,
one really good defense.
They're half a team.
They're half a team, and then the rest of it, quite frankly, it's pretty sloppy. Like for all the bluster of the Big Ten and how much money it brings in and the TV and the pageantry and the attendance and all that's great. But they got two really good teams, they got one good team, and then they've got a whole lot of mediocrity to flat out bad in the rest of that league. So the SEC, better. The Pac, top to bottom, better, longer. And then the ACC is back to that, you know, very top heavy, and then you know North Carolina was a disappointment in the ACC. Miami, some people would say they've been a disappointment in the ACC.
Six and five, dude.
Yeah,
after all that,
for all that, and you know, there's again a lot of Hurricane fans that have never been to the campus sporting U tattoos on their deltoids that have been disappointed this year. So when I look at that conference, I see a league that keeps wanting to get better, and I don't know if Stanford Cal is going to really boost the profile of the ACC, but doggone it, they're trying.
It's making it worse. I mean, it's
I look, know. With all,
this is we're coming up on the final weekend of college football as we know it. And we'll, of course, get into more of this tomorrow, Mike. We'll, you know, we'll have our driver on the SEC. We've got Fab Five and things like that. But this is it. This is the final weekend of the regular season of college football as we know it. I don't know if that's sank in for people yet. But the Big Ten next year, what that's going to look like, the Tupac, the – it's not the ACC, but it will be with those two from California. The SEC, of course, the changes with Oklahoma and Texas, it's the only thing that even fits in all of this. It's going to be entirely different in the way that things are going right now. Of course, it all changes because the portal's coming up and everything's going to get all out of whack and this, that, and the other. But the way that it's all changing, these major programs that are shifting leagues and things like that, think about the brands. Think about the brands. We talk about the brands all the time, right? So you've got major brands going to the Big Ten. You got UCLA, you got Southern Cal, you got Washington, you got Oregon. You know, they're all going that way. You got Oklahoma, Texas. We all know where the brands are going. What brand is going to take the biggest hit when they change conferences? And what brand is just going to, you know, keep the train on the tracks? They'll fit right in.
I think Oregon has a chance to go next level. In the Big Ten, the resources they have, the fan base, they have all the things we were talking about in the last hour. They've got all that in check, and they've got the right coach. And I don't think Dan Lanning is leaving. With all the there's so many rumors out there that I think are comical. I think Dan is staying put. I think Oregon is going to go in the Big Ten, and I think Oregon's going to be a player right away. Just my opinion.
Yeah, I what do you think about Southern Cal?
Well, you know, the Lincoln Riley, the whole Lincoln Riley bandwagon, it's people are jumping off that, like, you know, people that bought into crypto from that fraudulent dude who's now in prison. I think when you look at Lincoln Riley's rep, I mean, I've done a lot of games at Oklahoma, and you talk to those fans out there, and they're like, see, same old you-know-what. They don't play defense. They absolutely don't play defense. And you can't say he hasn't had enough time. The moment he got there, he was able to get a bunch of players, first of all, that he took from Oklahoma. Then they gave him a blank check in the portal and everything else and all these NIL deals, and it's L.A., it's California. And it's still, you have no defense. In year two. So I think there's a lot of people that are wondering, what do we really have here in Lincoln Riley? And, oh, by the way, Caleb Williams, you could make an argument, and he's still going to be a great draft pick, but he hasn't been terrific in big games this year. He was awful in the Notre Dame game. So what is Lincoln's expertise done with Caleb Williams in year two? I just think his stock has plummeted.
Somebody just compared Lincoln Riley to the Fyre Festival.
Oh, Netflix, that's classic.
Ooh, yeah, Mike was the first person that told me about the Fyre. I think we talked about it on JC and Morgan, actually.
We did, yes.
And I was like, I got to throw that in there, the Fyre Festival.
That's great.
Hey, believe it or not, on JC and Morgan, by the way, I did pick him as the one that would disappoint out of all those new coaches.
Yeah,
I hate to be right, but I'm right.
Yeah, no, you are. I mean, on the surface, it felt like too big to fail because, again, I'll use my term, the volcano program. There's no excuse why Southern Cal, and they hate to be called that, by the way, but there's no reason. Yeah, there's no reason why they shouldn't be a juggernaut. And Pete Carroll pushed all the right buttons, and he had it going on. Granted, they were slipping money under the table to people like Reggie Bush's family. But still, they had it going. And you had to think, like, okay, it'll work once we get the right guy. And when I tell you they G'd up Lincoln Riley, it's not just the salary. It's the house. It's the memberships. It's the everything. They gave him everything. And it's not clicking. It's just not, and now you're about to go to a conference in the Big Ten with Oregon, with Washington. So you have the same power programs that you're struggling with in the Pac, and then you're going to add Michigan, Ohio State, Penn State. How does that look for Lincoln Riley?
You have to play defense in that league too.
Absolutely,
because I mean, otherwise you're going to run into Iowa, and they're just going to line up and beat your nose in. And that offense is going to look like a juggernaut because you're soft on defense. I mean, mm-hmm. UCLA, like, I'll tell you who played good defense this year was UCLA. And I said that a few weeks ago. There were reports that they were going to fire Chip Kelly before the game.
I don't even know if that's
maybe not out of the woods yet.
He's not out of the woods yet.
But they go in there, and UCLA's played good, solid defense all year long. And they go in there, and what happened? They won. They lost to Utah, who plays defense. They lost to Oregon, who plays defense. Washington's not that great on defense, but they still lost to them. I mean, you got to say, and I heard the other day, too, there's talk out there Lincoln Riley may just say, heck with this, I'm going to go to the NFL.
Yeah, but I don't – is his stock real good for the NFL right now?
Dude, they hired they love these Wonderkin guys, though. I mean, they hired Cliff Kingsbury, dude.
Yeah,
I mean,
they did. But Cliff was lighting it up with quarterbacks in Lubbock. I wouldn't say Southern Cal has exactly lit it up. I think his stock has taken a hit on both fronts. Because you're right, he was rumored for a lot of NFL jobs not long ago. I don't know if that's in play, and because of Kingsbury and what a disaster that turned out to be, I think NFL teams will be more reluctant to just go for the quote-unquote offensive genius in college, especially the fact that Lincoln's, again, he's taking a dip here.
Yeah, I think there's one coach being the NFL next year that we talk about a lot, and he coaches in Ann Arbor, Michigan currently.
Yeah.
And I think he's going to be – he's coming my way. He's coming my way, folks. Him and his 10 kids can live out here in Humberland.
Can I just say this? I think Harbaugh is a bit of a – I don't want to use that word. I get why people hate him. I understand it. And he brings a lot of that on. But you know what? I want him to stay around college football. I think he's good for college football. A lot of people hated Spurrier, too. I mean, he's an arrogant SOB. He's great for college football. I like the personalities. I don't want it to become milquetoast the way it is with most NFL coaches. So keep Jim around, I say.
If he wins the whole thing, which they still could, okay. Frankly, we talked about the playoff. I think the top four teams are Bama, Georgia, Ohio State, and Michigan. Period. End of discussion for me. Those won't be the four that get in unless crazy things happen. But that to me.
Say those four again. Georgia,
Bama,
Michigan.
Georgia, Ohio State, Michigan. Two Big Ten, two SEC.
Yeah, I think
those are the
that.
Four best teams. But
talent wise, yeah.
I think the challenge. I think number one, he's disgusted about a lot of things in college football. People are out to get him. Number two, what's the next challenge for him? It's to go back where he played in the pros for a long time
and make them relevant.
And make the because he again the 49ers were terrible before he took them to the Super Bowl, you know, and he lost it. Remember, he didn't win the Super Bowl, lost to his brother. So we'll see.
To his brother, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Chad Rowe is on fire today, by the way. When they're not getting under the skin of you guys with this, a couple of insane comments, big slam of jammas. Does that make Caleb Williams Ja Rule? again, if you've seen the document, there's two of them. The Fire Festival. It's worth a watch.
Yeah.
Got to hit our final break of the afternoon. Hang tight. We'll be right back.
Hey, Gamecock fans. Mike Morgan here. During my time in Columbia, one of my favorite places to eat was Salsarita's. When I go back now for work or any other reason, it's still Salsarita's. Yeah, I'm like you. I love tacos. I love Tex-Mex. Where are you going to go to get them? Well, you've got two convenient Salsarita's locations, one in Lexington in the Target Center and one in West Columbia as well. Now, if you like tailgating, and who doesn't? Whether it's for a football game or anything else, they've got the catering hotline. Get yourself some Fiesta packs to take tailgating. Get yourself the Three Amigos bundles for tailgating. They make catering easy with a fresh, hot setup. And again, you just call the phone number 803-543-6297 to set it up. You can also look them up online or you can even download the app. Salsarita's is just a cut above the rest. That's why they're serving Williams-Brice Stadium and the South Stands, also serving in the Colonial Life Arena. Again, that catering hotline number, make it easy for you and the folks out there. You don't need to settle for sandwiches every time. 803-543-6297. 803-543-6297.
Shop Charleston Fitness Equipment this holiday season.
major discounts on treadmills, rowers, ellipticos, and more. Proud partners of Carolina Rise, Inside the Gamecocks, and the Chiefs Sports Network. CharlestonFitnessEquipment.com, 843-388-0999. Charleston Fitness Equipment this holiday season.
Final quick segment here on a pretty nasty Tuesday, at least where I'm at. I hope it's not that way for you. And we'll be back tomorrow, of course, at 11 a.m. as we take you right into the Thanksgiving holiday. A couple of quick things here from Coach Beamer. One, DeCarrion Joyner is expected to play this weekend. Thankfully, we'll get a chance to see him one last time at Williams-Brice Stadium. That young man deserves it. And excited to see him out there. He will, of course, will be recognized with the seniors as well. And number two, he basically confirmed what Juice said. Yeah, Juice will be returning next year. And he's not totally ruled out of playing this weekend either.
That's a huge get.
So that is not, set in stone. Spencer Rattler also today with the media made sure to point out, still got a year left. That's all he had to say about that. So we'll move on from there.
Don't see it.
Tonight.
Love to see it, but don't see it.
Tonight surely would make a couple other folks uncomfortable. Tonight, elite matchups in college basketball. Seventh-ranked Tennessee in Honolulu in the Maui Invitational to take on second-ranked Purdue at 8 o'clock on ESPN. The Boilermakers are 2.5-point favorites in that ball game, and then immediately following, 30 minutes after the ball game, top-ranked Kansas and fourth-ranked Marquette, also in the Maui Invitational at 10:30 on ESPN. The Jayhawks are 4.5-point favorites in that game as well. And another couple of interesting games. One will tip off in 30 minutes. Syracuse is at 11th-ranked Gonzaga. Both of them have an early season loss already. And then at 4 o'clock on the CBS Sports Network, 3-1 Florida State in Daytona Beach, and the Sunshine Slam will be the home team versus 18th-ranked Colorado. Their 4.5-point favorites are the Buffaloes in that game. So while all the hype was around primetime's football program, the basketball program just so happens to be better here in 2020.
I just had Florida State getting smoked by Florida, and I will tell you this. Florida, Georgia, and South Carolina, all three – now enjoying the second year of their respective coaches, I think are all going to be vastly improved.
Who looks the best in your opinion? Gamecocks are 5-0 after winning the Arizona tip-off, of course.
I've seen the other two up close in person. I haven't seen Carolina other than TV and video footage. So it's tough to answer. I think they all are similar in terms of talent level. And, of course, South Carolina hasn't even played with their full allotment of players. You got a guy that hopefully will be ready soon that I know some people are saying he's the best of the group. I don't know. I'm not prepared to say that yet, but I've been telling anybody who would listen, if you give Lamont Paris the right combination of players, you're going to see vast improvement. And there were so many people that quite honestly wanted to bury that hire before it even started. There's a lot of Frank Martin fans out there that clearly we're just going to bash whoever got the job and still resign out there. And you got people saying, we need more billboards. That's the problem. No, you need more wins, and you need a coach to actually bring more success to the program if you want more fans to come out. I am dodging your question because I don't know if I know the answer to that. Florida was really impressive in that win against Florida State. Now, maybe Florida State's just not as good as they normally are. And Leonard Hamilton's been there 22 years, and you just kind of wonder, like, okay, They had a bad year last year, and that was a really bad loss. But the Todd Golden in his second year, another hire that people are like, huh? He got a coach out of San Francisco? He can coach, and now he's got players out of the portal, and he's got talent over there. So all three of those are going to be improved in a stacked, and I can't stress this enough, stacked SEC. 5-0 is fantastic for this Carolina team. And I think you mentioned, Jamie, yesterday, you should pack the Colonial Life Arena for the Notre Dame game, support this team. They have a little bit of 2004 magic in my mind, a team that I'm pretty familiar with. But the SEC is going to be – it's going to separate contenders from pretenders real quick because it's brutal this year.
It is a very, very, very difficult league.
I love this song, by the way. Is this your – Jamie's your call?
That's why Phil went twice with it there.
This is Moby. Oh, okay. Did not know that.
Yeah. And it's all in the production, Mike. All in the production.
That's why I said you're meticulous. You do a great job. Can't wait to see that Ryan Brewer logo.
Hey, I texted him the other day. He didn't even text me back.
Well, he's waiting on the logo. He's waiting on the logo.
Hey, I'll be in. About texting, man. I'll be in at least for an hour tomorrow. I know I don't really take Wednesday off, but just for you guys.
It's too big a week to skip out, JC.
I'm coming in on the day off.
Carolina Clemson week.
I can't believe you. Yeah, we. Why would you be here for Clemson Carolina
week? We used to go 11 hours back in. I called it the Carolina Clemson Marathon.
We got to tell that story tomorrow.
I'll tell it tomorrow because
tell it tomorrow.
It's great how it came together and actually made national news. I think they still do it now in Columbia at a different station, but I don't get royalties for that, but it was a lot of fun back in the day.
Love Chevrolet will drive us all the way around the SEC. Tomorrow we will announce our Fab Five winner from last week. We'll make our Fab Five this week. We'll talk plenty about the Gamecocks and the Tigers. It's one of the great rivalries out there, and get Mike's thoughts on that. It's great to have somebody who sees it from 10,000 feet above, and Mike certainly will be able to dive directly into that. Have a terrific Tuesday. Don't forget your chicken cock. Thanksgiving will be here before you know it. Talk about the liquor. And we'll see y'all tomorrow from the Cinerama Studios at 11 here on Inside the Gamecocks, the show.